Lift, the use of the legs and the back is extremely important. Once the athlete stands erect with his knees locked and the bar on his back, the central referee gives the squat command. The lifter then bends his knees and lowers his body until the top surface of the legs at the hip joint are lower than the top surface of his knees. He then comes back up, locking his knees and hips in order to complete the lift. The central referee will then give the rack command and the athlete has to put the bar on the squat rack. There are three main mistakes to avoid in order to not have a no lift on the squat. First, if the athlete isn't standing erect with his knees locked at the beginning and at the end of the squat event. Second, if the proper competition depth isn't reached at the bottom of the movement. Third, if the athlete doesn't complete the lift with a single upward movement, meaning if the bar goes down during the ascent of the movement.
And we are back and ready to go, heading into squats in this morning's 84 plus B session. We will then follow with the 120 plus B session. We have two flights of lifters. We can see the running order as we are here. It is a very quick flight, just of seven lifters, and with the weights that they'll be lifting, you know, that's a pretty quick turnaround.
Yeah, that's been a theme here in Malta this year, with relatively quick turnarounds, not only in prime time, where they've had a little bit less time between sets, or I should say flights, but also short flights, because it is prime time. And this is going to be like that, with only seven lifters in this flight. And the larger the lifter, the larger the absolute loads, and the more they tend to need recovery. So I do hope these competitors have done some conditioning work, maybe tracking their rest period, so they're not impacted by this competition.
And as we count the clock down now, we have Maya Vaha of Malta opening with 130 kilos. Just 2 years in the sport and already at the World Championships.
And it's got to feel good to represent your country at the World Championships for the first time in Malta, where it is actually being held, and to kick the flight off. These initial squats will give us a temperature on depth, and as you can see, that was a little high, at least from two out of three of the judges. So that's the reason why you open conservative. I know I've been repetitive talking about that as I've been on every single commentary at this World Championships, but it's so important. You don't get to complete the meet if you can't register a total.
Yeah, it does bear repeating, and she's clearly strong enough for it. Hopefully she can come back on her second and get that. We move to Nadira Amran of Singapore now, opening on 155 kilos.
And Amelia, I do think she'll be able to come back and get that because she got, you know, one out of three, so it was clearly borderline. It moved well, and that's exactly the type of opener you want, so you can make that adjustment and then just take a little more aggressive jump from second to third.
Yeah, and she seems to have made the sensible decision of retaking the same weight.
Yes. Oh, wow.
Yeah, really speedy there. And a good lift. This is a great example of opening something with something that's clearly a bit conservative, and you can make those bigger jumps if you need, but just getting something on the board so you can push from there. As you mentioned before, you need to get at least one of each lift in to secure a total.
And I've got to think psychologically, and you could probably speak to this better than I could, that building that momentum, having a smooth opener, feeling strong at the very start of the competition when you might have just been feeling not too hot after travel, prep, everything, anxiety, is pretty important.
Yeah, it sets you up for, you know, a really good day with that level of confidence and knowing you've got that first squat on, which for a lot of athletes, that's the big one, you know, getting the nerves out of the way on that. Catherine Portelli of Malta now, 165 kilos.
And no surprise, we've got a pretty well-represented Maltese team here in Malta.
Unfortunately, she just gets two calls there. Red from the center referee and yellow one of the side referees. Let's have a look at the replay again here. Yeah, I think she's just sitting on that borderline, unfortunately, just a bit above it. And as we go through the weight classes, you know, and we're in the heavier weight classes, it does become a little harder to tell some of the time.
Yeah, when you're just a larger person, being able to identify all the different anatomical landmarks for the referees, having more spotters around you as well, it is a little more challenging to gauge depth. So this is really good information for the coaches and athletes to adjust in the warm-up room, saying, hey, we've already got two folks who got called on depth.
Manami Sato of Japan now, opening with 180 kilos.
Oh, nice narrow stance squat. That's pretty rare to see in some of these higher weight classes. Let's see if that was deep enough. No, I unfortunately kind of saw that coming. I don't know if you did as well.
Yeah, and I think if you can see it from that angle, it's likely that from the side angle it's no better. But we've got three lifters who haven't got the openers in, but as you said, that's why they open with a lighter weight, and it's something that they can come back and hopefully just sink a little bit more.
Yeah, and just to be clear, squatting 180 beltless, even a little bit high, pretty damn impressive. So
yeah,
clearly the strength is not an issue, and hopefully she can make the adjustments and come back and get that on her second.
And may I add, with no knee sleeves either.
Good point.
Desiree Wilkins of USVI now opening on 182.5 kilos. And that certainly looked a lot deeper than some of the others to me.
Yep. Nice and controlled descent, making sure she's in the right position. There was a blue card on that, which I didn't personally see, but of course we're a little bit further back. Let's see if the replay picks it up.
Looked good from here, and she gets two whites in it. Good squat.
And two whites isn't quite as secure as it used to be with the active jury. That seems to be the direction that Worlds is going, but they're not deliberating over that at all, so I think she's definitely safe.
Yeah, it's not just a case of convincing three referees. It's also a five-man jury today as well. Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria, 187.5 kilos. Locks it out. That is a good lift.
That was very solid. And, you know, squatting later in the flight, you get the benefit of seeing, especially on the squat opener, how the calls impacted all the lifters. And that may have been in her head. I did hear, I think, her coach or one of her teammates kind of saying, hey, I'm assuming in another language, I don't speak it, down, 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 up, but not sure.
Monique Body of USVI, opening on 200 kilos, our final opening squat of this flight.
And it's worth pointing out, this is the B group. These totals will be carried over into prime time later this evening. But this is a very impressive squat opener of 200. And the nominated total for Monique is quite high. It'll be interesting to see if she's able to secure a decent placing once all is said and done later this evening.
Squatting high bar, which is becoming less and less common.
Absolutely. That high bar position is typically not quite as strong for lifters, but as you can see here, just squatted 200 kilos high bar, and one call on depth. So she's right on the line, but yeah, still in there.
Yeah, we might be able to see on the replay there, the side that got that depth call.
And that's a good point. Sometimes you'll have just, not even sometimes, I would say most people have anatomical differences or even motor pattern differences on both sides. For a long time, I would get two white lights because I just didn't have the range in one hip that I had in the other.
Yeah, and you do see it a lot that they get the same red call regularly from the same referee because of that exact reason. We move through to second attempts now, and we have Maya of Malta, who missed on depth for her first squat, but it was very, very quick. So hoping she fixed it up a little bit in between and can get 130 now on her second.
Yeah, unfortunately we've got three out of these seven lifters who need to get their attempt here to stay in the competition, and now one of them is secure for at least registering the squat discipline total. That's three whites. She made a great adjustment.
Yeah, and let's hope the following two lifters can also follow in her footsteps and just convince them a little bit more that they're to depth. And first up of those two lifters, we have Catherine Portelli of Malta with 165 kilos.
Now, I'm not worried about these first two, but I am a little concerned with the Japanese lifter's close stance that getting to depth might be a problem. I will wonder if she will make any adjustment to her stance.
It's hard to tell when they move that
yes.
quickly into the hole, so we'll have to see what the referees say about that.
Unfortunate. I hope that there's one white, and I would be going to the jury right now if I was the coach, although they have been reviewing it on their own, so there's a chance she might get that overturned, but not sure.
Yeah, if you do have one white and two reds, you can contest that with the jury, and a lot of the time, especially in this situation, you're not losing anything by going over to them and asking, because you just want to get that.
Oh, I'm actually seeing the jury making some hand signals, putting a thumb up.
Seems like they are overturning that last lift to a good lift for Portelli.
Okay, so that borderline decision looks like it was just on the right side of the right border.
I mean, she now has a squat in and continue to build a total. We have Amran of Singapore now with 165 kilos. And 10 kilos didn't seem to add too much to the bar for her. And that's three white lights.
Yeah, there's a lot of strength left there. She's happy.
She points to the crowd. We can see that again. I don't think slow-mo will even slow that down too much.
Yeah, that's a very slight slow out of the bottom, but then she just accelerates through the rest of it. Now, here's where it really concerns me, and I hope she can make the adjustments, because this is a big squat, but with a narrow stance, there's only so much more range you can get out of your body.
Yeah, as you said, Minami took 180 on her opener with that narrow stance. She missed it on depth. The last two lifters who've done so have managed to get it back, so let's hope Minami can be the third lifter to do so and just find that depth a little bit more.
She looks a little wider to me. I don't think that looked... Oh, and there's a step, unfortunately. Even if she had hit depth, there was a bit of a bobble. You saw her take a step forward.
Yeah, and that leaves us in a really precarious situation, because now on her second, she still hasn't got a squat in, and should she not make it on her third, she's unable to post a total, but can continue to move forwards in the competition nonetheless, just not posting a total and being able to compete.
That's right. And good job to the spotters there catching that. Those unfortunate bobbles where you step forward can become a little more serious if they're not controlled. And a big thanks to all the volunteers here at Malta.
Desiree Wilkins of USVI now, jumping 5 kilos to 187.5.
I think that's a pretty reasonable jump based upon the speed of her first. And she is one of those lifters who likes to take a slow eccentric, get in the right spot.
Yeah, a lot of these lifters, you know, that tend to move towards tempo just like knowing that they can control that weight that is on their back, and that gives them a lot of confidence knowing that actually the weight I have on my back is under my control, not the other way around.
It sounds like there's psychological influences there.
There might be.
Interesting.
In almost everything.
I'll buy it when I see it and when I believe it, but I don't know. I think everything is down to physiology, says the exercise physiologist talking to the sports psychologist.
Sounds like a joke waiting to happen.
Most of my life is.
Stephanie Yerling of Austria now, 197.5, a 10-kilo jump from her opener.
And that looks a little deeper to me. She was borderline, and then when she... yep, this time, no reds. She's pretty excited.
Yeah, she skips off the platform, and I think... probably seeing some of the other calls, her coach said, hey, listen, you got one call last time. They're looking out for it. Just sink it a little bit more.
Let's not chance it.
Yeah. And she did a really good job of it and seemed almost surprised in herself.
And that is the beauty of powerlifting, thinking, oh, I know where my limits are. They're here. And then looking up, and you're past them. And you have to ask yourself, well, where are my limits?
Monique Body of USVI, jumping 7.5 kilos to 207.5 on her second attempt.
Coached by none other than legendary Kim Walford, sitting on the sidelines, coaching for Virgin Islands.
Yeah, and not a bad person to have in your corner by any means.
Absolutely not. Taking more time with the setup after the opener, which should be a lock, assuming there's no technical errors. This is when lifters really start having to get in a place that's conducive mentally to performance.
She gets the squat command just in time.
Fights through that stick.
It's a little bit more of a fight that you want to see on your second.
Absolutely.
But she gets three white lights.
But convincing depth. And man, to do that right with the buzzer clicking at your back, she had a pretty solid mental perspective, which I want to ask you, Amelia. Do you find it's pretty unique person to person what they have to do to be in the right mental space to perform?
100%. You know, different athletes need different levels of arousal. They get to flow in different ways. Some people, as you see, you know, get super hyped. Some people prefer a calmer approach. You know, everybody is an individual, and even two people that are similar will never be the same.
Makes complete sense.
Maya of Malta now, she missed her opener on depth of 130. She's moving 10 kilos up after getting it on her second to 140. On her third.
And kicking off these thirds, this is where it really becomes important to maintain that right perspective mentally so you can perform physically, and she does just that. With three white lights, she looks very happy. Always a concerning experience when you miss your opener comeback, but I don't think she left too many kilos on the platform, even though typically missing your opener means you just can't jump quite as close to what you think your max is.
Yeah, it wasn't top end, I don't think, but you know, she has a really wide stance, and that can be very taxing.
100%. It also depends on how she deadlifts, which we'll see later in this competition.
Catherine Portelli of Malta, another lifter who missed her opener on depth, got it on her second and has jumped 5 kilos now to 170 for her third.
A conservative jump. Oh, it's tough to see at that speed, but to me that looked a little higher than her last attempt.
I'm not sure. I thought it looked good. Yeah.
Oh, well, see, the speed fooled me.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was a sensible decision, I think, after, you know, a taxing experience like that to jump a small amount.
I think also what fooled me is it's so fast.
It's really quick. She definitely had kilos left in the tank, but took probably her planned second, which is often quite sensible than risking jumping over your second to your third.
100% agree. And sometimes when you see someone go quickly and then quickly on the way up, your brain goes, well, they must have cut depth because that was far too easy. But no, she's just that strong.
Yeah. Nadira Imran of Singapore, 172.5 kilos, a 7.5 kilo jump from her second.
And all of her attempts have moved quite well. I think she's probably good on this so long as she can keep everything in position and not make any technical errors. That's a beautiful squat and an interesting sticking point about two-thirds of the way up. And, you know, she hits it with speed, and it's all about just overcoming that momentum, or rather that inertia, without actually losing position. And she did just that, and she looked ecstatic as she left the platform.
Yeah, as you just said, look at that position that she keeps all the way throughout, and it helps her move those slightly heavier loads. Really good third attempt. Now we have Minami of Japan, and you said you were worried about her in her second, and she didn't manage to hit depth, so, and it did look a little bit harder, so let's see if she can come back, get 180 on her third, and be able to secure a squat to continue building a total in the rest of the competition.
This is a big deal, and I really just hope she trusts her spotters and just takes it as deep as she possibly can, because the worst case scenario, she'll be all right, she'll be spotted. But it's all about the confidence to actually hit that depth. That did look a little deeper, but I'm not sure it's deep enough.
I'm still a little worried, and yeah, unfortunately, she cannot contest it because it's three reds, and that means she cannot put up a total. She can continue to lift, but unfortunately she cannot compete. She cannot put up a total, but really good resilience to keep coming out and keep going for it.
Absolutely. It is an unfortunately harsh learning environment to have that happen on the platform at Worlds, but I have to say it's probably a lesson that won't be forgotten, and I guarantee you we'll see her in the future correcting that, because that is what athletes do. They show that they can overcome adversity and continue.
Desiree Wilkins of USVI now jumping 5 kilos to 192.5.
That methodical, slow, eccentric, but she's still good for it. She's actually got a fair bit left.
Yeah, and that looks really nice. As you said, super controlled, 3 white lights, and I think actually she shook some nerves off, and each squat seemed to get better and better.
Yeah, they didn't look too different from one another, just different plates loaded.
It's a good place to end up after your squats. You've got energy going into bench and into deadlift.
And probably a bit more confident than you otherwise had.
Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria now, jumping 7.5 kilos to a huge 205 for her third attempt.
And if she gets this, we'll have 2 lifters in this flight squatting over 200 kilograms. A big milestone in the 84-plus class. And honestly, it's a big milestone for anybody. Oh, nice fight.
She does a really good job of getting it up through the sticking point, and 2-1, a good lift.
And the fist goes in the air as she walks off. That's got to feel good to overcome that. Not much left in that squat by any means.
Yeah, and she hit step, but and does a really good job of getting it up. We have our final third attempt before we move straight through to the 120 plus B group, and this will be for a world M1 squat record for Monique Brody of USVI, 212.5 kilos.
This is a huge squat for anyone, let alone a master's lifter. Let's see if she's got it. And I'm allowed to say that. I'm a master's lifter.
You keep reminding me.
Yeah, it's been a rough year.
212.5 for Monique now. For a world M1 squat record.
Sets it up. Got a little more time on the clock this time, so she's not going to be chased by that.
She fights it up, and she gets the rack command. Let's see if the referees are happy with it. They are. It's a good lift and a new M1 squat record for Moonlight there.
That's a fantastic lift, and it looks a little better on the replay, but to me, I thought she actually squatted a little higher, but maybe it's just higher than where she was at, which was already well to standard.
Yeah, you know, I did see a bit of worry on your face, but the angle we get is a difficult one to tell depth from, and obviously the referees are in the best position to do so, so really great job there, and I think a perfectly called third. I think a couple more kilos would not have been there, and why would you need them if you're going for a record?
Absolutely.
And we are going straight through to the 120 plus B group, where we're going to see some very impressive lifting. Don't forget that any of the medals or standings will change. We've got the A's this afternoon, but we have seen plenty of times this week that people from the B groups have fought to get medals and succeeded.
Yeah, absolutely, or at the very least, some team points. For those who aren't aware, not only are these individuals here in their weight classes trying to take home hardware and get on the podium, either for the individual lifts or the overall placing, but the countries themselves get points for up to 5 lifters if they can place in the top 10, with diminishing points moving from first to 10th. So if you can place even in the top 10, you will get a fair amount of points for your team and potentially lead to team points and maybe a placement.
We have Pepe Van Zyl of South Africa opening with 270 kilos. That looked like a nice
solid
opening attempt there.
Now, you'll notice that he was just down to the last 7 seconds, and I have to think with these supers who shift the heaviest loads that we might be seeing a few times people coming down to the end of the clock as they are really trying to deal with this quick flight and quick turnaround here in Malta.
He did get a blue there from one of the side referees, and I'm wondering if that's because when he got to the top, he shot up so fast, there's a bit of a shake, but it's a good lift.
That might have been. It's typically blue cards on squats are up-down movement, so that possibly was seen by one of the judges.
Alexander Renov, Austria now, spots all of these spots and loaders saying, I know you got me, and opens on at 285 kilos. It's interesting, you know, we see in the 120 plus is a very large range of weights because, as you know, it's the open weight category.
Yeah, 120 plus. I mean, if you just take a look at who's in this B flight, you've got gentlemen weighing in over 160, and you've got gentlemen weighing in the 130s. So absolutely, you're going to see different body dimensions, different styles, and different strength levels.
That was a really strong opener from Renner.
And as we were saying earlier, there are a number of times where we've seen a B flight competitor sneak their way into the top 10 or even almost the top 5. And in the supers on both the men and women's side, we're basically looking for totals that are over 600 or over 900, well over 900, if they're expected to be in the top 10.
We have Lukasz Nizio of Poland opening on 290 kilos.
The Poland team is very happy with Agata Sitko taking home a silver medal in the 76-kilo class and bringing a pretty big team this year. And an excellent squat opener there from Luka.
That is a good lift. Yeah, and the Euro Championships were held in Poland in November of last year. And since then, I've seen, you know, a real surge of Polish lifters starting to compete more and more, which is really nice to always see, you know, more nations sending more international athletes to competitions.
I got to be honest, though, sometimes I feel like the Polish team is chasing me around just trying to beat my personal lifters, as I used to have battles with Krzysztof Wierzbecki in the 105-kilo class, and here we are trying to take out the undefeatable huge bencher herself, Agata Sitko, and coming in bronze with Jess Bittner. But I don't take it personally, and I'm not bitter.
Milan Smiljanic of Serbia opening 300 kilos. Sounds like you're over it.
100%. 100% of like 10%.
Taking a moment to settle his nerves, get focused. He's got a whole minute, so he might as well use as much as he needs to get in the perfect place to make this first squat.
Absolutely. And this is one of all the rest of the squats of this attempt being a number that starts with 3. That looked a little hard for an opener.
3 white lights, yeah, and that could be for a multitude of reasons. You know, some people do tend to open a little bit heavy, but some people just shake those nerves off, or they're trying to gauge, like you said, where the referees want depth. And so there's a lot of thought that goes into that first squat. So we'll see on a second, I suppose, how that moves and maybe which of those answers it is.
Absolutely. And the one thing that supers don't have to deal with is making weight, which is absolutely sometimes a variable. You're not quite sure how that's going to impact your strength. And in the 84 and 120 plus categories, you don't have to worry about making weight. So it likely is one of those other variables, you know, worrying about the judges or dealing with other aspects.
Jackson Stubberfield of Australia now opening on 300 kilos. Wow.
Solid lift.
And that is a good lift and a perfect example of maybe opening much lighter than he could have.
Yep.
But there are no points for opening heaviest.
Yeah, and like you said, the first attempt, especially on squats, the first one of the competition, you don't know how strong you're going to be. Doubt creeps into your mind. And it's just a very nerve-wracking lift. And getting it on the board is that first step towards actually being able to sit in your skin and enjoy yourself. Instead of just feeling the nerves. So it pays to be a little more conservative.
Jacek Juszczyk now of Poland. 300 kilos. Another very nice
solid
looking opener, yeah.
And he is actually the lightest of these supers. And hanging with the big boys, able to squat some big weights.
As you see the week go on, I'm sure you notice that the spotters and loaders start to look smaller and smaller as the weight classes get bigger and bigger.
And indeed, those spotters and loaders are not small people.
They are not, no. As you've seen from them catching loads of 300 upwards in their arms.
Yeah, after a few team Zercher squats that haven't injured anyone, you have to respect their strength and skill.
Absolutely.
But the weights are only getting heavier as we move into the depth of these attempts by the supers.
We have Jari Saario of Finland opening on 315 kilos.
Jari is a veteran lifter. I've seen him in many international competitions.
Takes a little pause in the hole there.
I think just based upon how the refs have been, he's been trying to make a very convincing statement about depth, but look at that. He actually got two reds, unfortunately.
Let's have a look again at the replay and see if we have a better view. Yeah, I think there it's easier to see that maybe it's not quite to depth, and that's, you know, a good example of why opening a weight like that for him is...
Oh, yeah, I was watching the jury while you were talking, Amelia, and I could see that they were deliberating over it.
Well, I'm always happy for that to happen. So that is fantastic news for Saario, and it means he can push his squat heavier as he'd be able to secure one. And now, a very popular man in the powerlifting world, we have Steve Ringu of Belgium, with 320 kilos.
A lot of support from the crowd.
He is a very well-liked man. From all countries, I think.
Very fast descent, tidy squat. He looks happy, blows through that stick point, and that's a solid opener.
Yeah, and that's three white lights. And I think that'll mean a lot to him because, if I remember correctly, at Euros of the year just gone, he didn't have quite a successful time with squats. He got called on depth, and I believe, you know, it's something that he's been trying to come back and prove a little bit.
I'll take your word for it. Unfortunately, I was coaching at Commonwealth, which was actually in my the town I live in, Auckland, and those two competitions happened at the exact same time, so I didn't get to see much of that lifting. But that is a fantastic feeling when you can come back from an error, make the correction, move forward, and still feel strong and progress forward.
Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei opening on 340 kilos.
Yeah, and we've really got some big squats happening here. And taken into consideration, once again, this is the B group, so these totals will be carried forward. That looked pretty good to me. A stance width and an upright body position where it's pretty easy to tell depth. But he actually did get one red card. So, yeah, it is generally more challenging as you move up in weight classes to really hit convincing depth. And, yeah, from that angle, I can see where he might have gotten a red card.
Yeah, it walks the line, I think, and could have gone either way, but it went in his favor, which is fantastic. And from the week, I've seen a lot of the Chinese Taipei athletes open very light and just make pretty big jumps to their second, which seems like probably what he will do.
Yep, indeed. And we've got Mehdi Mahfi-Gholami from Iran opening on 350. Iran bringing a pretty big team to Worlds this year. And he moves that very well. And once again, we're just going to have to see what they think about the depth. But to me, like I thought, pretty clear, three white lights. And that's got to feel good in a division where most people are getting by with at least one red.
Yeah, you can see he just sinks below that depth point there and gets a really good opener. And I don't want to speak too soon, but so far, so good in terms of openers. And we have one lifter left to go. Let's hope he doesn't prove me wrong with the rest of the production team looking at me. This is Sean Koch of Switzerland. Opening with a huge 367.5 kilos.
That is a big lift. And that, depending on how this moves, there's a possibility he could see a number that starts with four in his third. I am just hoping for that, to be honest, because that's what I love to see.
Absolutely. And it is more normal to see these bigger jumps with the heavier weight classes. So let's see how this first one moves for him.
And that is something to consider when you're gauging how much stronger do I think that lifter can be? How many kilos do I think they can jump? Jumping from 300 and 150, the relative speed and the relative load is the same, but the absolute kilos on the bar would be about double. So when you're squatting close to 400 kilos, you're moving big weights. And that moved fast, folks.
Yeah.
That's exciting. And honestly, the depth looked very convincing. And the referees agree. That's three white lights. And we might see a really big squat here, folks, in the B group of the Supers.
Yeah, that is very, very exciting. And it, like you said, it looks like he's got a lot left to go. So I'm excited to see what he puts in for his second. And that concludes our openers. And I can take a sigh of relief as I can now firmly say everybody has got an opener in and can move forwards.
Always a good sign. Only one lifter in the 84 pluses, but all the lifters in the 120 pluses staying in the competition.
We move now into second attempts, and first to take is Pepe Van Zyl of South Africa with 290 kilos. This is a 20 kilo jump from his opener, which is pretty usual we see at this weight class.
Yeah, very common, sometimes even a little more. And Steve, who we just saw smoke that 367, took a 20 kilo jump, which means we very well could see something around 400 on his third. And a solid squat there from Pepe.
2-1, a good lift. You just get a blue call from the side referee.
Let's see if we can spot that on the replay, but I don't see the jury deliberating, so I do think he's safe. There's obviously three referees from three different vantage points, and they're closer than we are here at the commentator's table.
We have Alexander Renner of Austria, jumping 20 kilos to 305, so flying past that 300 mark on his squat second.
I would also go back and just say that Koch is nominated over 900 before with just his opener, bench, and deadlift. So if he can actually put something up in the high 900s, and especially if he could somehow manage to total over 1,000, he's going to be a problem for some of the A-flight lifters who are trying to make rankings.
Well, a little bit of a fight, but he gets it up nicely.
And here's where we're going to start to see the quick-moving aspect of this flight and the discerning nature of the judges wanting to see convincing depth potentially start to lower the expectations of some of these lifters. And we'll probably see some big fights on these seconds. But hopefully everyone has made the adjustments they need to hopefully get an attempt at least on a third.
Yeah, and as you were mentioning about Sean of Switzerland, he nominated his squat at 360. And as we just saw, he opened just a little bit heavier than that. So his nominated total being 922.5 kilos, maybe a little bit under of what he can do.
Yeah, absolutely. We don't know how much someone improved, and the window for when you can give a total to be nominated is relatively broad, and as we've seen, some people get moved around from prime time to B flights. They're not always necessarily to the standard that the IPF wants to see for what a nominated total is, and it has changed which lifters are on which flights, so there is some ambiguity around these nominated totals.
310 kilos on the bar now for Milan of Serbia.
That's very solid depth, but an extremely tough fight as he hits that stick point.
Yeah, and like you said, it was good depth. It was three white lights, but the trade-off for hitting that depth sometimes can be it is a little bit harder to fight it up.
And if people are wondering why simply squatting deeper can take so many kilos off of your bar. It's because strength is highly specific, and we have a lot of research over many decades showing that at specific joint angles, you can be a certain amount of strong, but that doesn't necessarily transfer as you get away from that joint angle. So if you constantly train at a borderline depth, getting significantly deeper may mean that your body just simply doesn't have that strength in that position.
Eric Helms, PhD, 2023.
PhD CSCS, Amelia.
I'm so sorry. Lukasz of Poland, 310 kilos, a 20-kilo jump from his opening attempt.
Now, that's about what you want to see with the second attempt. The bar obviously slowed, but there was no challenging stick point, which means you've got a little room to go and gauge your third and hopefully get every kilo out of yourself you can.
Yeah, and on his first, we did say it was a really good conservative opener, and I think even the jump he made then, you know, has left him with a lot of room for his third, so be exciting to see what he puts in and how he does with that. But first up, we have Jacek Juszczyk of Poland with 315 kilos, a 15-kilo jump from his opening attempt.
And we're nearly halfway through the second attempts, and we haven't seen a single missed squat yet. And typically when I say something like that, someone misses. So hopefully I did not curse anyone.
Well, for those of you who are superstitious, we are fine. And that is three white lights and a really nice looking second attempt.
Well, I think it's because my elbows are touching wood. So we're good.
Jackson Stubberfield of Australia, jumping 22.5 kilos to 322.5 for his second attempt.
You know, that seems like a big jump, but his opener moved very fast. So I think so long as he can keep position and he's not thrown off by the big jump, which isn't that big when you're opening at 300, that he'll be all right. And squatting in the Nikes.
It looked like a 22.5-kilo jump was a really nice jump for second there for Stubberfield.
That was a good decision, I think, because he made short work of that. It did look like a second, but I would say it didn't look like a hard second.
Absolutely, and I can hear the Australian team endearingly call him Stubbs from the crowd. Mm. Well done, Stubbs.
It's almost impossible to not shorten things or have a nickname when you're in Australia or even New Zealand.
That's England as well.
Yeah, it must be just a Commonwealth thing.
Yeah. Steve Ringoot now of Belgium has jumped 15 kilos to 335.
And he was very happy with the squat opener. Let's see if he can even continue that streak moving into his second. And you can see these big men have a veritable army of spotters behind them. Excellent job, Steve. And he takes that with a fast descent, blows through the sticking region, and he looks extremely happy, and the crowd is as well.
Yeah, really great job. And as I mentioned before, he didn't manage to get squatting in Poland. I just wanted to double check that, and he's coming back with a vengeance, and he looks looking strong today.
You love to see the redemption arcs for these lifters when they have a poor performance. It sometimes just leads to their best ever.
Jari Saario of Finland, taking 340 kilos for his second attempt.
And I mentioned earlier that last big jump was 22. This is 25, Amelia.
Yeah, this is the biggest jump we've seen quite yet.
But like I said, Jari is a veteran super heavyweight lifter and a very good squatter. And And that was a challenge, but he did stand up with it. Now, he was on the borderline with depth, but this time he gets three white lights, very convincing. And when there's three whites, the jury is pretty much not going to be involved. And they're not looking, so he is safe and making short work of his second attempt with only three left to go.
Yeah, gets another 25 kilos on his total there. I'm doing a really good job of building it. Not sure there's another 25 kilo jump in there, but, you know, that is up to him and his coaches to find.
Well, I'd say not to that depth.
No. Yeah. Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei, jumping 20 kilos to 360, and his opener was really nice and speedy.
It was, and I think, if I recall correctly, Amelia, wasn't it right on the line, did he get one red for depth?
I believe so.
So he's got to make this convincing. Few of these supers are riding the line, which is one of the bigger concerns, not just am I strong enough, but am I riding that line on depth a little too close? Let's see if he can make the right adjustments or just maintain the same depth he had in the last one.
That's out a battle cry, and 2-1, a good lift. It could be a case of, like we said before, just one hit, not being able to get in the same position.
Yep. And I see one member of the jury looking at the replay, but so far, not too much action. He nods, so I think he is safe. So he's going to stay flying close to the sun, but not so close to get burned. We have Mafi Hualami coming out for his second. He also makes a 20-kilo jump. This is just one of the last three squats two squats remaining in this second attempt flight.
And it looked good from here. Let's see if the referees agree with that.
Yeah, that speed was pretty similar to his opener.
He does a really good job of finding, I think, the perfect level of depth where he's not wasting any energy, but he's not at risk of being called.
Yeah, and he's got very consistent positions, very tidy squat.
And now, we have Sean Koch of Switzerland, who surprised us with his 367.5 kilos, 7.5 kilos above his nominated squat, and has now jumped 20 kilos to 387.5. So should this be good, we may see another 20 kilo jump above 400. We'll have to find out.
And there was no question of depth, and it was very fast. So I expect if there's no technical error, this will be a pretty impressive squat as well. So it did slow down, and that actually looked like something that challenged him this time. Still getting three whites. I'm not quite sure if he's going to go all the way to 400, but you know he'll be tempted to.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not fighting for podium at this point, you know, or if you were fighting for a squat medal and not for overall position, then maybe it's a risk worth running at this stage. We'll have to find out, but you know, we also don't know the level of that specific lifter's ability to grind out a squat. You know, we see plenty of lifters pushing through a 15-second squat and getting it.
That's right. And it may sound strange, but a 10-kilo jump would be conservative when you're squatting nearly 400, and it would take him to 397. In almost any other weight category, a 10-kilo jump is not conservative. It's pretty standard.
Yeah, and it's, you know, you're not just taking that 10 kilos, you're taking the entire weight again plus 10 kilos, and it takes a lot of energy.
Absolutely.
Pepe Van Zyl of South Africa has jumped 10 kilos for a solid around 300 kilos for his third and final attempt.
And this is a great milestone. Anyone who can squat 300 kilos is incredibly strong, so I'm sure he's excited to give this a shot.
Dips it into the hole.
Just a little too much, unfortunately. And you could tell that might have been a problem for him, even on the way down, just finding the right depth and keeping control.
And that was our first third attempt and our first miss. So a very successful session so far.
Absolutely. And just having the opportunity to go for a third is what feels pretty good as a lifter. And you want your lifter to have the opportunity to push themselves to their limit, and all of these gentlemen are getting that and getting their second attempts and being able to take a shot on goal with their third.
Alexander Renn of Austria now taking a conservative 5 kilo jump. And as we said before, you know, you have to do the whole weight again plus some, so it's worth taking a conservative jump and getting your third in to build your total.
It's interesting to spot how these lifters get themselves in the right mindset for their squat. They tend to get a little more amped up, but not to the point where they lose control, because the squat is a highly technical movement. Oh, great bite. And he's smiling on the way up.
Really good call, I think, from the Austrian team.
Very good attempt selection.
And a good lift. And yeah, you tend to see people use more and more mental and emotional energy as they go through their lifts. You know, if you go on holiday with a certain amount of money, you're not going to spend it all on the first day. Otherwise, you're left with no money. And the same is with energy.
You're explaining why I got stranded last time. I'm learning things every time you talk, Amelia.
And every day is a school day.
Absolutely. At least it is in my life.
Milan Smogjanic of Serbia, jumping 10 kilos to 320 for his third and final attempt.
Now, Amelia, I've got a question for you. Do you find that beyond just the order of attempts, are there differences in the way that lifters need to get themselves in the right headspace per the different disciplines?
Absolutely. You know, it's not often you see someone who smacks their head for deadlift do the same for bench. Everything is different. The same way as you're not going to get in the same mindset to do work as you are to go to the gym.
So my smelling salts are not helping me write my manuscripts. I'll remember that.
Wow.
And just does not give up his position as he gets into that sticking region. That is one of the signs of an experienced lifter, is when you can keep composure both mentally and physically when the weight really starts to press you back towards the floor. An excellent squat there.
Yeah, he did a really good job, and the coaches are calling a number that was hard, but he's not emptied his tank heading into bench.
That's right.
Jacek Juszczyk of Poland, jumping to 322.5 kilos for his third attempt.
And, you know, I'm thinking about what you said about the different strategies for the different disciplines. I even noticed that sumo lifters on the deadlift don't get nearly as hyped as most conventional lifters do, at least on average.
Yeah, on the more technical lifts, there's more to think about, so. It's a lovely third there from Jacek.
Really good.
Three white lights, a good lift, and again, saving some energy moving forwards to build a total.
That's right. As the day goes on, it is all important to conserve enough energy. And many supers don't have SBD days. That typically starts to become less and less common as you move up in the weight classes. So they have to think a little differently about competing and game day energy conservation compared to, say, a 59 kilo lifter or a 66 or a 47 or 57.
Lukasz Nizio of Poland, also taking 322.5 kilos, a 12.5 kilo jump from his second.
And that's a good call right there.
Yeah, maintained position really nicely, and I think all three calls for his lifts have been excellent.
I have to say, this is already, and I can say this and not even be superstitious about it, even if everyone missed from here on out. Okay, maybe not if everyone missed from here on out, but given how many attempts have been made thus far and the fact that this is the super heavyweight division, I'm pretty impressed with the attempt calls in this flight.
Yeah.
This is some high-quality lifting.
Absolutely, and, you know, it does tend to be the super heavies that you see more misses on, and to see a sea of greens, you know, everyone getting their first and second attempt in is very impressive. I completely agree. We now have Jackson Stubberfield, or Stubbs, as we hear from the crowd, taking 335 kilos for his final attempt. Getting a little bit more hyped this time around.
Yeah, you can see that look in his eyes.
Right now.
His squats have moved well, so I think he's got a very good shot at this. Big deep breath.
And it looked like the perfect call for his third attempt. Let's see if the referees are happy. 2-1, a good lift. He does get a depth call, but...
Yeah, I actually was a little concerned about depth as he was going down, and I'm seeing most of the jury members looking at the replay. So there is a possibility that this might be taken away from him.
They look happy.
Yeah, they don't seem to be deliberating, which typically means he's all right.
We move to Steve Ringu of Belgium now, taking 342.5 kilos for a third and final attempt.
And he's fired up. Just a little too much.
Unfortunately, not quite there today, but still walks away with 335 kilos in the second attempt, which is not a small squat.
Yeah, he looks a little disappointed, but overall pleased. And it makes sense when you think about what he's overcome recently. Now, I didn't want to say anything, Amelia, but we've got a 400 kilo squat coming up later.
I have just seen that, and as we know, you can't change a squat attempt. You can change deadlifts twice, but that means we're going to see a 400-kilo squat attempt.
That's right.
Just in four lifters' time. But first, another huge squat attempt by Yari Sario, 357.5 kilos, a 17.5-kilo jump from his second to third.
Now let's see if he's good for it. The brakes came on a little more in his second attempt. Oh, that's a fight right there. Just a little too much.
And a really good catch from the spotters and loaders. And I was a little worried if he expended that energy and perhaps not got the lift for depth anyway.
That's right.
Look here in the replay. I think it was just a tad on the line.
Yeah, if you looked at his first and his second, he got to that same point he got on the third, and then he kind of, almost like an equipped squatter, dipped lower just to kind of show that he did hit it. And that time he didn't. He just kind of hit that bottom point and came back up. So it could have been a case where even if he had walked, stood up with that, where he might not have got it. And that's almost worse.
Yeah, after using that much energy. So perhaps better that he gave up when he did rather than fighting through to not get those extra kilos.
Absolutely. We can't know for sure, but it may be why he deadlifts another 2, 5, or 7 kilos later tonight or this morning.
Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei jumping 10 kilos to 370 for his third and final squat attempt.
And he's been riding the line of depth with getting one red light on each one of his attempts. And as it gets heavier, it's harder and harder to not cut depth a little more, as we just saw with the previous lifter. Let's see if he can maintain composure.
Wow.
Amelia, did that look deeper than his last 2 days?
I think it might have. Let's see if the referees agree. Two of them did.
Yep. Not convincing that one ref.
No, but that's the same referee that's giving him a red each time. So, you know, we can't see what that referee sees. And there probably is the case that that hip is a little bit higher. But nonetheless, the jury aren't talking. He gets the lift.
And just like we had in the 84-plus category, we have Mehdi Gholami from Iran going for a M1 squat record of 387.5 at the World Championships here in Malta. This is an exciting moment. This is a big squat and an impressive feat for any lifter, but even more so for us old people.
And he's, on his first and second, maintained position so well and been able to shift the weight excellently. So let's see if this extra 17.5 kilos for an M1 squat record does the same. Fights it up.
He stands up with it. Let's see if the refs think he was able to meet the standard on all aspects technically. Oh, unfortunately, a 2-1. Looks like the coach is going to go to the jury, who is already crowded around the instant replay.
Like we said before, if you have one white, you can contest it. And, you know, in a scenario like this, why wouldn't you?
Oh, we've got...
It has to be a unanimous decision.
It has to be a unanimous decision when you've got three members on the jury. And when you have five, you need a 3-2 decision.
It's been overturned.
Which looks like exactly what they got. I saw one thumbs down, another person unclear, and then three actually putting their thumbs up. So that was about as close to the sun as you can get without burning.
Now we have Sean Koch of Switzerland in the B group taking 400 kilos for his third and final attempt. This is a massive amount of weight.
And when your squat starts with a four, there is a good shot you could potentially get a squat medal depending upon how our prime time does, or at the very least push that total up into a number that might get you some team points. Oh, Sean hits that sticking point, and he seems to be one of those go, no-go type of squatters.
Yeah.
Where he takes it with speed down, and if he can get the ability to break through that inertia, he'll get it. But unfortunately, just a little too much, but a valiant attempt on a huge squat that most people can never even dream of hitting.
Yeah, absolutely fantastic from Sean there. And, you know, if he was able to get that up provisionally on nominated attempts, he would have been in bronze for squat. So it was a risk worth taking, and we can see here as it stands, Mehdi in first on body weight with 387.5 kilos provisionally with squat gold. Sean Koch of Switzerland with the same weight, followed by Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei with 370 kilos. We are going to take a short 9-minute break now and come back for bench press. We will see you then.
The bench press is the second movement performed in a powerlifting competition. It's a movement that mainly uses upper body strength. A slight back arch is authorized and allows for a stronger and healthier shoulder positioning. Laying down on the bench, the athlete has to create points of contact between his held shoulder, glutes, and the bench. His feet has to lay flat on the ground with the heels in the contact with the floor. Once that position is locked, the central referee gives the start command. The lifter lowers the bar until it touches his chest. The lower underside of both of his elbow joints have to be at level or below the top surface of each shoulder joint. He then has to stabilize the bar for the referee to give him the press command. The lifter has to push the bar back up until the complete extension of his elbows. The central referee gives the rack command and the lift is completed.
There are four main reasons to have a no lift on that movement. First, if you're not able to fully extend your elbows at the beginning and at the end of the movement. Second, if you don't touch the chest with the bar, or if your elbows don't go at level or below the top of your shoulder joint. Third, if you're not able to maintain all points of contact with the bench, knowing the head, the shoulders, and the butt. Fourth, if the lift isn't completed in a single upward movement.
Hello and welcome back to Maleta Volta IPF Open World Championships. I'm Amelia Potter and I'm joined here today by Eric Helms. We are just going to have a quick look now at the 84+ B group women's squats as we've just seen them. Currently sat in provisional gold, we have Monique Boddy of the USVI with 212.5 kilos, followed by Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria, 205, and then another USVI athlete, Desiree Wilkins, 192.5. Of course, this is all provisional as we have the A flight this evening, or this afternoon rather, where we will see where those medals end up. Now, we've seen some big squats today, and I'm imagining we will see some pretty big benches as well amongst the 84+ and 120+ women. And to start us off, we have Catherine Portelli of Malta opening on 70 kilos.
And I think we'll probably see a few less, I should say, maybe technical errors or on the bench press, just because the short time period with only having a small flight of seven competitors is not going to be as much of a problem with a less fatiguing movement like the bench press.
Less fatiguing, but often more technical in a lot of cases.
Very true.
Really nice and speedy there.
Make short work of it. Very conservative opener.
It's worth mentioning the current World Open bench press record in the 84+ is 164.5 kilos. Now, this is the B flight, but we do have a lifter from the USVI opening on 130 kilos. So maybe we won't see the record, but we're going to see a big bench in this flight.
We will.
Maya Vaha of Malta opening on 82.5 kilos. Maya is the lightest in this weight class at 90 kilos, so just above that 84 mark.
That's right, and that is Monique Boddy who will be going for that 130 squat opener, who also just clinched the M1 world record in the squat. So she's probably going to put together, at the very least, a very good subtotal.
Three white lights. Looked a little bit hard, but then, you know, some people just continuously add weight and the bench stays the same. We see with bench press, though, that the drop-off point for most athletes, I think it's safe to say, is pretty hard and fast.
Yeah, it tends to be the most go, no-go of all the lifts. It's not one you can generally grind through to the same degree.
Desiree Wilkins of USVI now, also opening on 82.5 kilos.
Virgin Islands with a pretty big team this year. It's good to see that. That's a fast opener.
Yeah, it looked really good. And just like her squat, super controlled on the descent there.
And there is a trade-off there. You're basically ensuring that you're in the position you want to be when you start pushing, but at the slight cost of a little more fatigue during the eccentric or the lowering phase.
Yeah, and similar to squat, some people just prefer to be in control of the weight the whole time. I'm sure we will see lifters who take the opposite approach where they sink it very quickly into their chest, you know, and try and use some of that momentum to get the bar up.
And that is a skill in and of itself, taking a more aggressive descent, being faster, trying to get the benefits of that stretch reflex, but maintaining control. And if you don't train like it regularly, it can be very challenging.
Nadira Imran of Singapore, opening with 85 kilos.
Moves well.
That is a good lift.
She looks very happy, clapping as she goes off.
Now, that was a very speedy opener. We see here Manami of Japan, who unfortunately wasn't able to post a squat due to depth, but she's continuing to compete. And coming all this way, I think it's a good decision to get that international experience while you're here. Where else could you get it?
And to be honest, I have to say, unless there's an injury, it's the thing to do that helps you be a little more resilient, finding a way to move forward and have a little bit of amnesia about what happened and focusing on, hey, what can I do on these next disciplines? As old people like me say, it builds character, Amelia.
Absolutely. It does build character. And we can see here that the Japanese lifter is opting to wear a size shirt that is quite large. And I'm wondering if that's perhaps to hide some depth issues. We're seeing a few more athletes wearing ill-fitted shirts.
Yeah, it's something I've definitely noticed, and a lot of people are talking about. The speed at which athletes are adapting to the new bench press rules, where for those who don't know, your elbow has to clear the top of the shoulder when viewed from the back to be considered depth. Trying to maybe wear a large baggy shirt could be some strategy. At least they're trying out to see if it makes it more difficult to gauge when depth is not hit.
Stephanie Gerling of Austria, 105 kilos, and making light work of it there on her opener.
And so far so good for the lifters in this flight, and now we're moving into that big bench press.
Yeah, and this is a flight of seven, as we said before, so it moves very quickly. You know, each lifter has a minute on the platform, but by no means do they take the full minutes. That's not 7 minutes in between.
Absolutely not. And engaging your warm-ups and your attempts and your recovery with the time that it takes to move through each lifter is an important skill of an athlete and their game day coach to ensure that they are able to warm up properly and not miss any opportunities to get ready.
Monique Body of USVI, 130 kilos for her opening attempt.
And you saw, like many of the lifters, she communicated with the spotters to get the kind of liftoff she needs that she regularly trains with to put her in the best position to succeed, and that is an important thing to do in competition. Moved pretty well.
Yeah, it did move well, and that is three white lights. I'd be interested to see what kind of jump she takes for their second.
I'm expecting five if they're going to be conservative. They could go seven, although it looked like she was a little hesitant in trying to get to the right spot on her chest, so if I was a coach and I spotted that, I'd probably go five, especially if I communicated with her and that's where she thought she had the capability to go.
And that concludes our openers. And with the 84+ B women, everybody has made sure to get an opener in and is good moving through to their second attempt. We have Catherine Portelli of Malta jumping 5 kilos to 75.
Nearly gets out of position. Let's see if the judges felt like she was able to be technically sound. She did get one yellow card,
which could be for the lifting of the head or feet, as well as skipping the command. Let's see. I mean, you can see some movement in her lower body there, but it's hard to tell. And the jury don't look like they're discussing it. So, Maya Vaha of Malta, 87.5 kilos.
And that 5-kilo jump, which threw her off a little bit, is something to consider, because a 70-kilo bench is a smaller number. So a 5-kilo jump is a relatively large proportion. It's actually a relatively aggressive jump in my book. Well, it looks like she got a little bit of a hamstring cramp, but gets three white lights. And that's an interesting thing to see right there. Someone doing a bench press and getting a hamstring cramp. For those who aren't familiar with the style of bench press done in powerlifting, you really use as much of your body as possible to drive that bar up. And there are actually stories of people tearing a hamstring or even a quad as they're benching, especially in the heavier weights. So leg drive is a factor.
Yeah, and her feet were a bit more back. So, you know, it tends to favor that a little bit more as well. Nadira Amran of Singapore, 92.5 kilos for her second attempt.
And you know, Amelia, to what I was mentioning earlier, I'm typically not doing 5-kilo jumps until a lifter is into the 80s or 90-kilo bench presses. What are your thoughts on that?
I think, you know, and that's a good lift. I think, it really depends on that lifter and how conservative maybe the lift before was. As far as game day coaching, I'm sure you're a better advocate for that. But I think it's so specific to each lifter and the way you're approaching the day. 5 kilos does tend to be a very conservative jump a lot of the time, at least in the heavier weight classes. But, you know, if you're talking about a 47-kilo lifter, that's a lot of their body weight.
It's more than 10% of the lift. So, that's exactly right. It is just about that proportionality of the weight. And here we are going from 82.5 to 92.5. Pretty aggressive bench press jump, I would say.
Yeah. It's a 10-kilo jump from our opener. So very controlled, just like our opener.
But she's good for it. And to your point, this is one of those times where I think individually this made sense to do, because she took a very conservative opener. And that may just be the best strategy for a lifter. Again, this is the B flight, so this may be some of their first time at Worlds. And just registering a total and being more conservative on the opener, but not losing out an opportunity to go for something that's challenging, could be the decision process.
Minami of Japan, jumping 7.5 kilos to 97.5. Seems like a relatively normal jump from first to second in round about this weight class.
Yeah, absolutely. Once you're getting into the 90 range, there's certainly a little more leeway to make those larger jumps. And her opener did move pretty well. Let's see if 7.5 is the right number. A little too heavy. It's possible she got out of position. We will have to see if she's able to come back from that on her third.
Yeah, let's have a look again at the replay, because a lot of the time for lifters, bench can be very technical, and losing position just a little bit can really affect how you push it. But you won't know until her third whether it was positional, whether it was strength, or what the issue was. And let's hope it wasn't strength.
Absolutely.
Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria, taking 112.5 kilos. Another lifter opting for a 7.5-kilo jump.
To your point, Amelia, you were saying it's a little more technical. Often the reason for that is that right off the chest is where the lift is most challenging. So if you are not having the right trajectory at the very start of the lift, it can look like it just was not going to happen. Oh, unfortunate. And that's exactly what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
She came a little more straight up than backing up. Got out of the bar path that she needed and moved from an up-down into a full miss, unfortunately. Hopefully she can come back and correct that on her third.
We move to our final second attempt now with Monique Baldy of the USBI. And as you correctly predicted, she jumped 5 kilos, which seemed like a good choice, from 130 to 135 for her second attempt. This is a big bench.
Yeah, nearly on the cusp of the 300-pound mark. And that's something that this lifter might actually care about, being from the U.S.
Absolutely. That beep you hear represents 30 seconds left on the clock.
Taking her time with a methodical setup. Wow. And you see that? The bar came back before it moved up, and once it got back far enough into the point where she had the right leverage, it pressed right up into a very solid attempt. I'm predicting maybe another 2.5.
Yeah, I think 2.5 is the safe choice there to be able to build the total and put a third up. 2.5 kilos is the smallest increment you can jump unless it is a record. And at this level, it would have to be an open world record for it to be a chip.
That's right. And even if you miss a 2.5 kilo jump, you've basically left no kilos on the platform so long as a miss on strength. So it's hard to be disappointed. So psychologically, also a great jump, winning that's the appropriate call.
Catherine Portelli, 77.5 kilos. A 2.5 kilo jump, and I think a good decision from the team Malta there.
And that actually looked better than her 75. And I would say that probably has to do with jumping 5 kilos on a 70 kilo bench. That's quite the shock if you think about 5 kilos relative to 70 kilos. But going 2.5 on the next one, even though it is a heavier weight, 77 versus 75, it's going to feel a lot more like that 75, enabling you to transfer that technique that you just used in your last attempt.
Yeah, and I think it also has to do a lot with what is that particular athlete used to making jumps and training with? And I think that plays a big part in it.
Very true.
Maya Vaha Malta jumping 5 kilos to 92.5, an equal jump from her second to third as was from her first to second.
Unfortunately, the brakes come on.
Just a bit too much today there for Maya.
It's all smiles, waving to the crowd. It's hard to be disappointed when you are from Malta, competing in Malta at the World Championships.
A 2.5 kilo jump now for Nandira Amran of Singapore. Opting for a safe, conservative 2.5 kilo jump, perhaps feeling like she's at, you know, the tail end of her strength today.
And it's better to be a little conservative versus going over and losing unnecessary kilos. Let's see if she's good for it, or maybe she'll surprise herself. No, I think she accurately gauged where she was at, although I do think she got a little out of position there.
Yeah, I was about to say, it looks like just off the chest she loses position and the bar moves forwards. And when it's your top end weight, you know, that's very hard to pull back from.
And here's a good angle you can see on the replay where it starts to come back, shifts forward, and that's almost impossible to come back from when you're nearly at your max.
Yeah, that's hard to do when you're kind of midway, let alone, you know, top end.
Absolutely.
Desiree Wilkins of the USVI now, jumping 2.5 kilos to 95 for her third and final attempt. I think well gauged there.
Excellent job, yeah. So a 10-kilo jump and then a 2.5-kilo jump, both successful. You have to think it was a conservative decision. Let's get on the board, build some experience. And then they went, oh, well, that 10-kilo jump was pretty challenging. And then made the right call because there wasn't much left there at all, I don't think, on 2.5.
Yeah, absolutely. Minami Sato of Japan retaking 97.5 kilos. Now, we weren't sure if it was a positional issue or a strength issue. We're hoping it's the former, but we're not so sure.
We will see here. Doing a self liftoff, which ensures you're in control and you get the liftoff you want.
Unfortunately, no. I think it was a bit of a strength issue. Just maybe opening a bit too heavy or jumping a bit too much to her second.
Yeah, it may be that she had 92 or 95, but that was certainly above the limit today, at least.
Just two bench presses left to go, but don't go anywhere because we head straight into the 120 plus B group for bench, where we've seen already some very big lifts, an attempt at 400 and, you know.
An M1 world record as
and
well.
An M1 world record.
Yes.
What you said. Stephanie Yerlinger, Austria, 112.5 kilos. She missed it on her second. Coming back to see if she can get those extra kilos on her total now for her third.
And I think she's got a good shot at this. It looked positional last time. There wow. It is.
Let's see if they're... Yeah, EY Lights, she does a good job of fighting it up. Two or three different stops along the way, but yep. No downwards movement by the seams of it.
And she heads off with obvious mixed feelings. Glad she's able to get it, but disappointed that she missed it in the first place.
You'd rather get it eventually than not at all, though.
100%.
Now, our final bencher of this flight before we move into the 120 plus is jumping 2.5 kilos, as we might have suspected. You know, a nice conservative, safe jump for a big bench. 137.5 kilos for Monique Bode of the USVI.
She's taking a shot on just over 300 pounds. That's a very big bench press for anybody, and definitely a big bench press for this weight class. And all the ones below it. Which is all of them. Taking her time just like her last setups. It's been a successful strategy, being very, very, very methodical. Let's see if she can do it again with a slightly heavier load. Oh, it looks like it's just a little too much today, unfortunately. But as I mentioned before, hard to be too disappointed when it's just not there and you don't lose out on anything.
Yeah, absolutely. And she still walks away with a huge 135 bench. And who knows, that could be big enough to get her a bench medal. We'll have to find out later when we see the 84 A flight compete this afternoon. And as we can see here, provisionally, Monique from USVI... 135 in bench gold, followed by Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria with 112.5 and Desiree Wilkins of USVI with 95. And I think that's pretty similar to where the squat standings were for the 84 plus B group were also.
Yes, Monique had a very big squat. She had an M1 world record as well. And that was a very big bench press, as we just discussed. And she's actually nominated right now with her opener deadlift at 577. Which means she might be able to tip over the 600-kilo mark. And the 600-kilo mark is somewhat of a milestone in the 84-plus category, which is probably going to put her in a spot where she's getting at least team points. And something to say in the B category. A statement of, hey, next time, put me in prime time, damn it.
Yeah, absolutely. And to kick off the bench for the 120-plus B group, we have here Pepe Van Zyl of South Africa. He'll be opening on 160 kilos. Now, he's only been competing a year, so doing a fantastic job of coming up and fighting at the World Championships here in Malta.
It's always nice when this is your first international competition because you can kind of look at anything you put up on the board as a personal record or a personal best and something to improve upon. And certainly, I think it's worthwhile taking that perspective, because at the international level it is very challenging to improve, or I should say perform, like it is at a local meet in your backyard. So here's this first attempt by Pepe at 160 from South Africa. Communicating with the spotters, making sure he gets what he needs to be in the position to succeed. Moves very well, exactly like an opener should. And he gets three white lights, so he can build on that moving forward.
Body
Now we have Lukasz Nizio from Poland opening on 175. He's overseen by the very experienced Polish head coach. Lots of different bench press styles you see among these lifters. This is a relatively close grip, which increases the time it takes to travel and range of motion, but that is no barrier for him as he blows up his opener. And just like the sumo deadlift, you're trading range of motion using a wider grip on the bar for having a little more power. And for some lifters, especially depending upon their joint build and any prior injury history, that can be the right decision. And here we have Pei Yu Wang from Chinese Taipei, opening on 185. Also a very fast opener, and you'll see he elected to allow the bar to sink into his chest a little bit, which tends to give a little more elastic force, helping you through the stick, but also increases the range of motion. And all these little technical aspects of the bench press are things that experienced lifters play with in their career to try to play the game of optimization to get the most out of the lift that they can. Jari Saario from Finland on 187.5. As you can see, he's taking kind of a midway point grip between the last two lifters. Pretty wide, but not as wide as possible. And also sinking.
A little harder than you'd expect an opener to be.
Yeah, and a very high stick point as well. And it didn't look like he fully locked it out, unfortunately.
Let's hope that was something he can come back and fix on his second attempt.
And this is the first time we've had a lifter miss their opener. We had everyone register a squat. But Jari there is, unfortunately, it looks like he wasn't fully locked out at the end of that bench press. So he'll have to come back and take that again.
Jackson Stubberfield now of Australia, opening on 190 kilos.
Getting encouragement from the crowd and the Australian coaching staff. Stubbs is opening on 190, an impressive bench press, and we'll see a lot of bench presses in the 200 kilo range in this flight.
Very speedy opener there. And 220, good lift. He gets a blue call from the center referee.
Interesting.
And I'm wondering if we can see in the replay maybe what that would have been for.
Amelia, I wasn't able to spot anything wrong with that.
No, I mean, it looked good for me, and it looked good for the two side referees, so he gets the lift nonetheless.
And we've got Mehdi Mahfigolami opening on 195. This is our master's lifter who just, in the last discipline, snagged the squat world record for M1. Let's see if he's as competent in the bench press as he is in the squat.
Seems to be.
Registers a solid opener for Team Iran.
It's a good lift. You can see Saario of Finland has made the sensible decision to stay at the same weight for his second attempt. And I don't think it's, based on this opener, not worth the risk. So good decision there. We move now to Jacek Juszczyk of Poland, opening with 210 kilos, so already above the 200 kilo benchmark now.
And I agree with you, Amelia. It's a rare case where you go up on a missed opener, and typically reserved for people who are in prime time and fighting for a medal or a position, and they know that if they don't take it, they just will not be able to get in the contention spot they need because it is very competitive these days in powerlifting.
Absolutely. And that was a really lovely opener from your Czech there. And if we can see on the replay again, the touch on his chest is so soft. And it benefits him to get a quick press command.
And that's the exact opposite strategy from sinking, where you get that slight benefit of the elastic recoil of just your ribs flaring out as you press. But exactly like you said, Amelia, you're trying to get that quick call. Because if you look at the IPF technical rule book, you won't get the press command till the bar is motionless on your chest. So if it's still sinking through your body, or if it's unclear to the referee of whether or not it is stable and unmoving, you won't get that press command as fast, sapping valuable strength as it rests there on your chest.
Milan Smiljanac of Serbia, opening on 215 kilos. An example there of a little bit more of a sinking technique.
And very fast. Now, one thing you can't do is, after getting the press command, letting the bar sink even more, because that's essentially just downward movement into your chest. And that is sometimes what you can get called on, but you can sink as much as you want. You just simply can't let it sink after the press command when the bar should only be moving upward.
215 kilos now remains on the bar for Alexander Renner of Austria.
His time setting up, fills his chest cavity with air, lifts the chest nice and high to produce that range of motion and stay nice and stable.
Wow.
Very powerful.
Yeah, and just like his squat opener, very, very fast. Seems like well below his capabilities. And so I'm expecting to see a pretty hefty jump from him.
That's right. And the bench press being so technical, sometimes you're limited, despite the absolute load, with what's a reasonable jump. For example, legendary coach Matt Gary is loathe to jump more than 10 kilos, no matter what you're benching. But I think we'll still see some jumps higher than that.
Yeah, but I mean, Matt Gary's a good person to take that kind of advice from on game day handling.
Yeah, he does all right.
All right, yeah. Steve Ringoot now, Belgium, taking 220 kilos for his opening bench.
Very powerful bench press, and that's a solid opener for Steve. And he leaps up, showing that super heavyweights are athletes just like everybody else. He could probably dunk a basketball, Emilio.
I bet he wouldn't even have to jump. He's a very tall man.
Yes, he is a very tall man.
By the looks of it, the Austrian took Matt Gary's advice and jumped 10 kilos.
And look at that. And Matt Gary's influence lives on.
We have Sean Koch of Switzerland, 220 kilos, opening heaviest on bench as well as on squat.
Yes, we have two, just like the 84-plus class, this is one of two athletes, one in each, who is a standout with the highest nominated total, although actually, Mafi Golami is right there with him. But this is a really big bench. Wow.
It moved very well for him.
That did not slow down at any given point in time.
No, and often you can see, you know, with the sinking technique, it can get kind of messy when it gets into their chest and, you know, pushing it out. But he keeps a really good position and keeps the control of the bar the whole time.
Absolutely. Sometimes with that sinking technique, you'll see it shift laterally or up and down when viewed from the top down on their body, instead of just moving straight up or backing up. But no problem for him there. Let's see if he can maintain that type of control as he moves into heavy loads.
We have Pepe Van Zyl of South Africa jumping 12.5 kilos to 172.5, so just above that 10-kilo mark you were talking about.
Mm-hmm. And according to our stats, this is 12.5 kilos over his personal best, which he did just 3 minutes ago. Like I said, early stage competitor, great to register some numbers and get the opportunity to continually improve and look at that as a milestone.
Stop.
unfortunate. Hopefully he can make some adjustments there. I do think, based upon how his opener moved, he does have a shot at that 12-kilo jump, but that... Let's take a look at the replay, see if it was a technical error.
It's hard to tell. I mean, when I first saw it, it did look like it was a strength issue, but, you know, with bench press being so technical, it's so hard to tell some of the time.
It is. To me, it looked like he touched a little lower on his body than he did on his opener. It might be that he just wasn't able to control the descent.
Let's hope that is the case and it's something that he can change. Jari Saario of Finland now, who missed his opener at 187.5, is retaking it now on his second. Now, again, similar to the last lifter, we weren't sure what the issue was, and we're hoping it's something that he can fix and get a bench in.
Oh.
And it looked better. Let's see.
Now, was there downward movement? That's going to be the question there.
There was not. He is on the board, and he can breathe a sigh of relief.
Yes, his back was against the wall. Unfortunately, he was able to complete that lift. It looked like a combination of technical issues and it just being a limit lift for him based upon how his opener and his second attempt moved. It looked like he was able to control the lateral movement on the bar, you know, up and down his body that time and fight through that stick point.
Lukasz Nizio of Poland jumping 15 kilos to 190 on his second attempt. Now, Lukasz has been opening very conservatively, so if anyone, I think he justifies a bigger jump.
Absolutely. Well said, Amelia, and you can see that moved quite well. Looked like a very solid second attempt.
Yeah, and just like his squats, you know, keeping pace really well. There's no point of opening it too heavy on bench or on any of the lifts. It's just not worth the risk.
100%.
Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei now jumps 10 kilos to 195. This is just 5 kilos shy of his personal best bench.
If he's able to get this and get it convincingly, he's in a good spot to try to improve on that. That's a big sink right there. But a very fast press.
Yeah, does a really good job of that. And he gets 2-1 in good lift. He gets a yellow call from the center referee.
Let's see if we can spot what happened on the replay.
I think perhaps she saw his hips moving from the back and thought there was some lifting. But as you can see from the side there, his bum stayed in contact with the bench at all times.
As long as some part of your bum, as you say in your part of the world, maintains contact with the bench, that's totally fine. But if there's daylight seen, especially by the side judges, you'll absolutely get a red light.
Yeah, and that's exactly why they've implemented these lights now. So there's a better chance of the side referees being able to see that light shine through. And for the jury, you can see it just through there now. For Jackson Stubblefield of Australia with 197.5 kilos.
Ooh, he moves that very well.
Yeah, he jumped 7.5 kilos from his opener, which also looked good, and is doing a great job of just slowly but steadily adding kilos to that total.
I suspect maybe a similar jump, or maybe just 2.5 less moving into his third.
Yeah, and as we've said, with bench sometimes it can be so unclear when the drop-off point is, and sometimes for the athlete as well.
Absolutely. And we have Mehdi Mafigolami jumping 10 kilos to 205, representing Iran. Slows down, perhaps a little slower than you'd ideally want for a second attempt, but still solid.
Yeah, and a good lift. And I think maybe a 5 kilo jump there for him. That was a 10 kilo jump from his opener to his second, and perhaps taking a more conservative jump to his third will allow him to get those extra kilos.
I would completely agree.
Jacek Juszczyk of Poland jumped 7.5 kilos to 217.5 for his second attempt.
Light touch and a solid press with a little bit of a stick at the top, but it looks like it's good. Let's see if all the judges agree, and they do. That's three white lights.
Yeah, and as we spoke about before, the trade-off is you don't get the power from the sink as you would, but you are more likely to get a quicker press command, so waste less energy with it there on your chest.
One thing I've noticed is this World Championships, there's been relatively fast press commands, and some might say that's inconsistent judging, but I would say that probably speaks to the standard of lifter here at World Championships, able
Absolutely.
To show those judges that they've got control on their chest and therefore get the benefit of getting that fast call.
Yeah, it's not a case of 1-2 press. It's as soon as you see the bar stationary, that is when they press. And if that's instantly, then it's instantly.
And that's exactly what you want to create with the practice you do in the gym, making sure that you show control over the bar so you get that benefit.
Milan Smiljanic of Serbia, 225 kilos.
And that's a nice visual milestone of getting four red plates on the bar with the collars. And he gets it 2-1 with a yellow card. I don't see much deliberation happening over the jury table, so he's probably going to keep that. But let's see if we can see what exactly happened when viewing it from the side.
Again, from this point of view, it's pretty hard to tell, and I can't see the jury discussing anything, so I think he's safe there. We have Alexander Renner of Austria jumping 10 kilos to 225, and his opener, just like his squat opener, was super speedy, and I think a 10 kilo jump is more than justified for him.
Absolutely. And it looks like the next two attempts are going to be over 500 pounds on the second attempts, which is a pretty impressive set of bench presses after this one. And they are cleaning the bench and the bar, so there'll be a little delay here, which I'm sure none of these gentlemen have a problem with, so they have a little more time for recovery.
Yeah, and you know, you as a coach or a lifter can request that the bar and pad get cleaned down before any of the lifts if you want to, and often you just get a build-up of chalk both on the pad and in the bench, and you know, it causes more slipping than it would otherwise. So if you want to give yourself the best opportunity to get the best positioning and you think there's a lot of chalk build-up in there, you can say, hey, can you just wipe that down for me, please?
And also, if you simply need more rest, you can say that you want the bar cleaned.
Yes.
And that 1 minute countdown for your attempt to be registered will, or at least the initial command to be registered for the bench press, will start only after the bench has been cleaned and they say the bar is loaded and call you out. So it could result in another 30 to 60 seconds of rest, which can make the difference if you're riding it close to the line or if you have a lifter who just needs a little bit more time or if their conditioning isn't quite up to snuff. That moves well.
Yeah, I think it puts him in a good position moving into his thirds. You know, it's normal to see a lot of the time a bigger jump for the first to second and then slightly smaller from a second to third, and I think that's exactly where that leaves him.
Absolutely, and the one thing you'll see most lifters not do, unless it's on the deadlift and they're moving for position, is take a larger jump on their second to third versus their first to second, because that tends to feel just too different from what you're used to and can result to it in a technical error, even if the strength might have otherwise been there.
Steve Ringoot of Belgium, jumping 7.5 kilos to 227.5.
And this is our first bench over that 500 pound mark. Oh, and
locks it out.
Steve makes it look easy for the first 70% of the lift and then has a strong fight right at the top, but is still getting three white lights. He looks pretty happy. I think he's going to have to take a pretty conservative third, though, if he wants a chance at it.
Yeah, and, you know, that's what you see a lot of the time with this kind of benching, is it can be pretty speedy off the chest, but it starts to slow down near that lockout point.
That's right.
Sean Koch of Switzerland, 235 kilos, our final second attempt before we move into third. A 15-kilo jump from his pretty easy opener.
Yes, I suspect. And again, this is a 15-kilo jump, which is a pretty big jump on bench press, but again, this is a big bench presser, and it did move very quickly. I think he's got this. Also, even more impressively, a relatively close grip for the size of this man. Oh, now, that looked like it just stopped and didn't move down, but let's see if the judges agree. Well, most of them do.
Yeah, 2-1, and I think the jury probably looked to check that over as well, since he got that one blue, and we can see on the replay. It's hard to tell if it tipped back or from that angle or tipped down, so.
I think if I was going to make the call, it would be that it tipped back a little bit, not down. And one thing that is important to note is that if you can't tell, you're supposed to give the benefit of the doubt to the lifter. So I think he's going to be all right.
Which is fantastic news, and I suspect a smaller jump to his third.
Yep, and he only put in 5, which is a very conservative attempt when you're benching that much weight.
Pepe Van Zyl now jumping, he missed 172.5 kilos in a second, and he is retaking it now on his third. We weren't sure what the issue was 100% here, so let's see if he's been able to fix something up.
Well, now he's used to this weight. He's taken it once, so hopefully if it's a technical issue, which it doesn't look like it was, it looks like it was on strength, but he had a good scrap with it.
Yeah.
I'm sure he's disappointed, but if you can't lift it, you can't lift it, Amelia.
Exactly right, Eric. And the thing is, you know, it moved better than his second, but if the strength isn't there, yeah, and his bum came up as well, so even if he did, it would have been somewhat a waste of energy. So he gets a bench in, and that's the most important thing, because he can move forward and continue to build a total.
Yeah, if there is a discipline to only go 1-for-3 on, it would be the bench press, because you're typically adding much more to your total with the squat and the deadlift.
Jari Saario of Finland now missed his opener on what we weren't sure whether it was strength or technique, but got it in his second and has jumped conservatively 5 to 192.5 on his third.
Now I think this will be a challenge, because every bench has been up to this point. And it does seem like he's walking a narrow line where he has to get the right combination of factors to get this, and unfortunately he's not able to. That looked a lot more just like strength to me, unfortunately. And he goes off holding his elbow. He might have had a little bit of pain, or hopefully not a full-blown injury impeding his ability there. Now the good news, I guess the not bad news is probably a better way to put it, is an elbow injury probably won't impact his deadlift at all.
Lukasz Nizio of Poland now jumping 10 kilos to 200 for his third and final attempt. And I imagine this is a big milestone for Lukasz. And as we know, his lifts have all looked pretty consistent and good so far. So let's hope this 10 kilos is a good jump for him.
Well, he made that 15-kilo jump look better than most people make a 15-kilo jump look. So I suspect he'll be all right here. And he may even have more left. Is he going to fight through? Unfortunate. You know, I feel like if he just had a larger gas tank, maybe he could have. But yeah, he probably had something like 9.
Yeah, that extra couple of kilos was a bit too much. Maybe 7.5 could have been the right call, but everything is in hindsight.
Yep, and I was wrong about that. I expected him to get that just based on how everything else is moving. But when you've got a close grip bench press like that, you do tend to see those pretty hard stops that you just can't fight through.
Yeah, what I think is, you know, close grip is somewhat the conventional of bench, and it's fast off the chest as is conventional off the floor, and then slower at lockout.
I think that's an excellent analogy.
Jackson Stubberfield of Australia now, 202.5 kilos, a 5-kilo jump from his second attempt.
Let's see if Stubbs is good for it. Very light touch, gets a fast press command, and that probably was a limit lift, Amelia. He got that with not much room to spare, and he looks pretty happy.
Yeah, managed to get that top end bench without completely emptying the tank, and I think that's exactly where you want to be on your third. Not leaving too many kilos there, but not, you know, draining yourself of energy before deadlifts.
Absolutely. And it really does depend on how you bench, on whether or not it'll affect your deadlift. Like I said, some people do get hamstring cramps, and obviously that'll affect a deadlift. But a more flat back bencher who doesn't rely too much on leg drive, they might be able to get away with it. But that's not most benchers.
Peiyu Wang of Chinese Taipei taking a 10-kilo jump to 205, and this will be for a 5-kilo personal best.
Jumping 10 and 10, so he's having a good day on bench if he gets this. Taking advantage of that sink, and that moved actually quite well, not too dissimilar from his opener to his second. So he's probably got more in there.
Yeah, he does get a yellow call from a side referee, which could be for a lift of a body part, a jumped command. But it does look like his hips move. We can't see from that angle. The jury are talking, but
there's a possibility this could get overturned, as the jury is spending more time talking about it than they normally do when they leave a lift alone.
But they look like they've stopped talking about it now, which is great news for the lifter. 210 kilos now, a 5-kilo jump for Mehdi.
Let's see if Afi Kolami can go 6-for-6. Oh, excellent fight.
Wow.
And he's building quite the subtotal.
Yeah, it seemed like a perfect call. However, I think he jumped the rack command at the end. I think he was tipping back a little bit, it seems. Let's have a look here. Just here, as he locks it out. His foot came up and he slipped back.
Unfortunate. Well, he'll know the strength is there, and that'll certainly drive him in his next competition, knowing that he has the confidence to hit that number. But yes, bench is very technical.
Jacek Juszczyk of Poland, 222.5 kilos, a 5-kilo jump from his second attempt.
That's a conservative jump, especially on a bench press this size. It's rare you'll ever see a 2.5. Because 5 is probably going to feel very similar to a 5-kilo jump. And as you can see, he barely got it.
I'm wondering if he jumped the command there.
Yes, I think you're right. Good spot.
He did get one white somehow, but I'm not sure they can contest that. It goes to his chest and straight off. I think when you get close to your limit, your body tells you when to press, and it's hard to fight that.
Yeah, you will see that sometimes when people are a little nervous about their strength. They will just kind of automatically go to a touch and go. And you can occasionally get away with it when people are getting fast press commands, but that was probably just a little too close to the line.
Milan Smiljanic of Serbia, a 5-kilo jump to 230 for his final attempt, followed only by three other lifters. And we will have a short break before deadlifts.
Oh, and that moved a little bit downward on his body, I think more than he intended.
Yeah.
It's very difficult to press from that position.
Yeah, as you said, I think when he sunk it there, it kind of rolled down his body somewhat. You'll probably be able to see that on the replay from this angle. There and forward.
Yeah, right before the press, unfortunately. And it's nearly impossible to press from a position that is not the right position when you're near a limit load.
Steve Ringoot now taking a 2.5-kilo jump to 230, feeling perhaps like he's at that tail end of his strength for the day.
And as I mentioned, 2.5-kilo jumps are pretty rare when you're talking about these types of lifts, but hell, when you think that's all you've got left, it is the best call if you think it's worth it. think it'll be just unfortunately too much.
Yeah, but luckily, because of the small jump, he doesn't lose too much there on his total by not getting it.
No, I mean, all he can say there is, well, I didn't make any mistakes, and I got every kilo I could on the platform, but I just wasn't as strong as I wished I could have been.
Absolutely. And our penultimate bench of this morning's session, we have Alexander Renner of Austria with 230 kilos, a 5-kilo jump from his second.
Strong word usage, Amelia. I would not want to play Scrabble with you. Penultimate? Fabulous.
Thank you very much.
Stays smooth throughout.
Yeah, a really well-pulled third there, and a really strong day so far from Renner.
Yeah, that's unequivocal. He got three white lights.
I know you're looking at me. It was also a good word, Eric.
I was definitely fishing for that compliment, and I appreciate it.
We'll play Scrabble later.
And you'll find out who won later today.
Now, our last bench of the 120 plus B group, by Sean Koch of Switzerland, 240 kilos, a 5-kilo jump from his second attempt.
And that is a huge bench press, building a massive subtotal, if he can get this. And honestly, even if he can't get this, it's still a huge subtotal.
With this, he might even see himself ending up with a bench medal from the B group. So, see how that works out.
Oh, I almost thought he was going to get through it, but
yeah.
Unfortunate, just a little too much. Disappointed, but honestly, still a fantastic bench press.
Yeah, really, really good effort. And, you know, if mistakes are made in the A group, there's absolutely still a chance he could get a bronze medal on bench there with his 235.
And it wouldn't be the first time to happen. We saw Donna Yi Lee do that in the women's 57-kilo class from the B group.
Yeah, and even yesterday in the men's group, we saw two of the B groups end up getting a medal. So it definitely could happen. And just before we head to a break, we can see where the bench press medals are provisionally. We have Sean of Switzerland with 235, followed by Alexander Renner of Austria with 230, and Steve Ringu of Belgium in bronze provisionally with 227.5. Don't go anywhere. We'll see you in 9 minutes for deadlifts.
The deadlift is the last movement of the powerlifting competition. On that movement, the lifter's whole body is used and put to the test. The athlete approaches the bar once the central referee calls bar loaded. He then has 1 minute
to start the lift.
In the conventional or sumo position, the athlete has to pull the barbell until his shoulders, hips, and knees are fully locked. Once that position is assumed by the lifter, the central referee will give the down command. The bar has to be lowered to the ground without the lifter being allowed to drop it until it touches the floor, which completes the lift. At the end of deadlift, the powerlifting total is made, which determines the winner and final placings. There are four main mistakes to avoid. First, not locking your shoulders, hips, or knees at the end of the movement. Second, not completing the lift with a single upward bar movement. Third, completing the lift, hitching at the legs in order to allow you to do so. Fourth, dropping the bar after the central referee down command.
Hello and welcome back to the IPF World Classic Open Powerlifting Championships here in St. Julian's, Malta. I am Amelia Potter, joined by Eric Helms, and we are heading first into the 84+ B group. As we can see here, the standings before, obviously, the A group this evening, we have Monique of the USVI in provisional gold, Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria in provisional silver, followed by Desiree Wilkins of the USVI in provisional bronze. Now, they all need to be able to put up a deadlift in order to complete their total. Unfortunately, we have Minami Sato of Japan, who wasn't able to get a squat in, but she's come through and continued to compete, and I think it's probably the right thing to do there.
Showing resilience. She's got a bench posted.
Absolutely. And we can see the running order here as it stands for deadlift. And there are some big deadlifters coming up in this B flight.
And once again, Monique, who is the biggest squatter and biggest bencher, if I recall correctly, looks like, at least based upon openers, it's also going to be the biggest deadlifter.
Yeah, I imagine she just missed out on being in that A flight. First up, we have Maya Vaha of Malta, 155 kilos, and a lot of support here from the home nation.
And a sumo deadlifter. A solid opener.
And that is a good lift, and she's secured herself a total. If you've got a squat and a bench in, you know, it's worth just opening that little bit lighter on deadlift so that you can secure a total. And then if you need to, just make a slightly bigger jump.
And if there is one lift that tends to be fine with uneven or larger jumps, it is the deadlift, especially conventional, as it is a, I wouldn't say it's the least skilled movement, as it is very individual, but it is absolutely a grip and rip movement. It's for some people.
Minami of Japan, 165 kilos.
Making light work of 165.
2-1, a good lift. Just a red there from the far referee for insufficient lockout.
And I was wondering if she would get any red lights for that. Not only in the, mostly the knees, I think, is where they're probably looking, do you think, or one of her shoulders?
It's hard to tell because this side obviously got the white light, and I think as we get into the bigger weight classes for men and women, the lockout sometimes can be harder to see. Mm. But she gets the lift nonetheless, and we have Nadira Amran of Singapore opening with 167.5 kilos.
Another sumo deadlifter. This one's a little more clear on the lockout, and I don't suspect she'll get any reds.
Yeah, and that was a very easy, conservative opener, exactly what we were talking about. Just get that total secured.
An interesting thing I've noticed, and I don't have data to back this up, but when you move through the heavier weight classes on the men's side, you tend to see a shift from sumo to conventional. But I haven't seen that be the case among the women. I don't know if that's on average more flexibility in the joint or just the difference in height. But interesting to see that there are so many sumo pullers in the 84 plus.
Desiree Wilkins of the USVI opening on 182.5. Now, with her squat and her bench, she's been very controlled. So it'll be interesting to see how she pulls, because it's not normally a lift that is a controlled lift.
Very solid. I think we won't know until she gets into some weights that are a little heavier and she has to really challenge herself and put forth some more energy into the bar. If it's, she's anything like her coach, Kimberly Walford, there's probably going to be some energy behind those heavier loads.
Absolutely. And with this being such a small flight of lifters, the time in between these big pulls is going to be probably shorter than they used to.
Yeah, we only have 7 women in this flight, so it's a fast turnaround.
Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria opening on 200 kilos.
And that's solid. You'll notice her knees locked a little before her back fully extended, and that's fine on an opener, although that may become a problem as she moves closer to her limit.
...200 kilos stays in the bar now for Catherine Portelli of Malta. That looked like a good lift to me, and it is. And it's amazing to see not only the amount of women lifting 200 kilos and above, but also with that much ease.
These are openers, folks. And speaking of an impressive opener... Monique Bodie from Virgin Islands is opening on an M1 world total record.
And if I'm not mistaken, she got the M1 squat record.
She did.
And this will be for the total record. And I'll be interested to see if maybe she's going to go for the deadlift record as well. I'll have to find out what that is.
Well, you definitely looked that up, because this is a very impressive lifter who is probably going to be placing at least in the top 10 in the overall for the 84 pluses. And this deadlift is not a record, but what it will add to her subtotal will be a record. Although it is a challenging lift, it looks like she's good for it. She gets the down command. I think she was fully locked out. She gets 3 whites. And folks, you just witnessed a Masters World total record of 577.
And actually, the deadlift record belongs to her at 235 kilos. So opening just 5 kilos below her own M1 deadlift record there.
Well, considering that, I would not be at all surprised if we didn't see 235.5 on her second. Although that was a challenging lift, I think it should be acknowledged that did not look like an opener.
So we'll have to see where she goes from there. But just like that, we are through to second attempts, and we have Maya Vaha of Malta jumping 7.5 kilos to 162.5.
Amelia, what was the old M1 total world record that she just broke?
I believe it belonged to herself.
So it was herself. What was the, was it just by 2.5 that she broke it by? And a successful lift by Maya Vaha with 3 white lights.
She broke it by 5 kilos, I believe. It was 572.5.
Interesting.
Which she got in St. John's, Canada, 2022.
You know, it's she might have been a little surprised by how slow that moved, because I personally would have had her go 2.5 lighter, which would have been closer to a probably more appropriate opener speed, and she still would have broke that world record. It might be that she's just not quite as strong on deadlifts as she expected to be based upon her last warm-up.
Minami Sato of Japan, 175 kilos, a 10-kilo jump from our opener.
And if you recall, she had 1 red light from not being fully locked out. Let's see if she can correct that. And I think what they're seeing with that mixed grip, one of her shoulders is not quite as far back. That might be what's happening. Now, with a mixed grip, that means that the other shoulder probably will be. So that might be something that she can continue through without actually getting knocked forward at the point where she picks up another red light and makes the lift invalid.
Yeah, and similar to squats, you know, with one hip being lower than the other, you often see one side being able to lock out just slightly easier, like you said, with mixed grip. So she seems in safe ground right now. Nadira Amran of Singapore, jumping 10 kilos to 177.5 for her second attempt.
A 10-kilo jump, and she makes it look just nearly as fast. Now, you notice this sumo deadlift with your feet spread wide essentially creates more of a balance challenge. And if you pay close attention right at the top, you'll be able to see it here on the replay. There's just a very slight bobble at the top. Not enough to create an up-down, but right there, you can see the shift of her whole body forward. Now, as the weight gets heavier and heavier and heavier, sometimes the challenge is making sure that you don't accidentally have an up-down or ramp or some minor technical fault in the sumo. So whatever advantage you get from the sumo, just know that it comes with a greater technical expertise required.
Desiree Wilkins of USVI jumping 12.5 kilos to 195 for her second attempt.
And looking on is one of the best conventional deadlifters in the game, Kimberly Walford. As Desiree makes short work of 195, still very sound deadlift. Did not look that much different than her opener. I expect to see either another 10 or maybe even another 12 and a half.
Yeah, you can see here how easy that moved for her. And yeah, like you said, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw another bigger jump there. Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria jumping 10 kilos to 210 for her second attempt.
Impressive that we haven't seen a single miss thus far. Oh, she fights for the lockout. Did she stay locked out?
Just waiting for that center referee.
And we're having a, okay, 2-1.
And again, pulling mixed grip, like you said, perhaps just struggling to get that overhand back quite as far.
But I have to say, Amelia, I'm impressed. We haven't seen a single missed deadlift yet thus far, almost through the second. And I know I'm being very superstitiously challenging, but the point is they only have 7 lifters. This is a fast-moving flight, and they're doing great.
Yeah. And that was 210 for Catherine Portelli of Malta, and another good lift.
That's right.
Superstition or not, if they're strong enough, they're strong enough.
And I just like to make people feel uncomfortable. But beyond that, I am truly just impressed because this is the deadlift is a fast-moving event. And on top of that, this is a short flight.
Yeah.
So these lifters are probably not used to this type of turnover.
So now, Monique Bodhi of the USVI, she beat her own M1 total record on her last lift. And I believe this is for an extension of the total record and an extension of her own deadlift record.
That's right.
Which currently stands at 235.
And I misspoke. I suggested she go 235.5, but she can't do that because this is not an open record. It's a master's record. So this is going to be challenging. And it gets...
Wow.
Oh! She gets it over her knees. Is that going to be ramping, though? She locks it out. This is going to be a tough call. She had the strength, but it looks like she's 2-1. I'm sure they're going to go to the jury's table after that. And looks like they're already deliberating.
They do, although Monique did look at the referees and kind of nod her head. I think she knew that maybe there was a bit of ramping there.
Yeah, when the knees shoot under like that, almost by definition, the bar is going to be sitting on top of them. So I think she's probably not going to be able to get the overturn. But she will get another attempt at it, maybe.
She will, and, you know, in her position, she might as well go for it again. So... just like that, we are already on to third attempts for the 84+ B group. And opening up for us, we have Maya Vaha of Malta, 167.5 kilos.
And you know, she probably had her game plan locked in even if she was looking close. Good lift there by Vaya. But yeah, Monique, when you think about it, if she was coming in thinking, you know, I've got a shot on both the deadlift and the total world record, I just need to be in a position to pull 237, which would get me more than a fair bit over my old total record, and would give me the deadlift, then what's a good place to jump from to get to 237? And 230 is a reasonable pull.
Yeah, and the good news is, even if she doesn't get that last pull, she's extended her total record, and she already holds the deadlift record, so not losing it to anybody else.
Absolutely.
180 kilos now for Manami Sato of Japan, a 5-kilo jump from her second attempt. So we've seen her get red carded on the same side each time, we think just struggling to lock out that one overhand shoulder.
And she managed to be in a slightly more locked out position by my eye from first to second, so hopefully it's not going to get any worse, and this is just kind of the way she pulls. Yeah, and notice that her torso is just a little tilted to the right, which is not an issue, but it does draw the eye of the judges. And this time it's 2-1. Doesn't look like they're going to try to challenge. I do see the jury looking on their own, but I don't think that's going to be overturned. Because the knee is also looking a little soft on that one from the side.
Yeah, I was worried that the knees were a little soft there. Nadira Imran of Singapore, 185 for her final attempt.
And you know, Amelia, that would be a lifter who I would try to coach into, if they had the thumb resilience and finger length, into a hook grip, so they wouldn't have to have that much of a asymmetry when pulling. Although it does take time to build that resilience in the thumb. The knees lock and unlock. But was that up down on the bar itself? You shouldn't do that on the platform. She holds her head in despair as though sensing that she missed the lift. You got to display that confidence. Fake it till you make it.
At least she's honest.
She is. You got to give her that.
Yeah, unfortunately not quite there today. Oh, bless her. But still walks away with 177.5, which is a huge deadlift.
It is.
With just four deadlifts left to go before we head into the 120+ B group, we have Desiree Wilkins of the USVI seeming to take a pretty big jump now.
Now that is an unconventional jump right there. She went 12.5 on her first, and now she's gone 20.
I had to double check the maths there.
Now I will say, she looks like she has 20. I don't think that's an unreasonable call. It just means that perhaps they got a little surprised by how quickly she moved her first and her second.
Yeah.
And if there is a type of lift to make an asymmetrical jump like that, it is the conventional deadlift. And look at that.
Oh, I think, I don't want to speak too soon, but I think she did lean forwards at the top there at lockout.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's 2-1, and I don't even see Kimberly Walford going out to challenge it. I think she knows that it's probably not going to get overturned. And that is the one downside of even when you have this. Yeah, that's a pretty clear up down, unfortunately. That is the one downside when you take those uneven jumps, is it can surprise you, even if you have the strength.
Yeah. We have Stephanie Yerlinger of Austria jumping 10 kilos to 220 for her last attempt. Just a little bit too much of a jump for her there, unfortunately. But
an excellent scrap, though.
Yeah.
And on the third attempt between each one of them, they are cleaning the bar. Giving the lifters just a little bit more time.
Catherine Portelli of Malta with a 220-kilo third attempt.
And it'll feel good in your home country at the World Championships to go 3-for-3 on deadlifts. And it looks like she might be able to. Was there any up-down movement? Was the lockout solid? White lights, it certainly was, and they are ecstatic. The coach is jumping up and down, and the lifter is carrying the coach off the platform. You'll love to see it.
It's lovely to see. Now, with just one final deadlift to go before we head to the 120+ B group, we have Monique Bodie of the USVI. Again, going for 237.5. She just missed it on her second on lockout, I believe. She's going again for it on her third to extend her world M1 deadlift and total record. So the bar is loaded for Monique, and she's going out for 237.5.
And this was an incredible struggle to lock out last time and didn't quite get it 2-1. So if she can get this, it would show extreme resilience and stamina. Let's see if she can do it. No, and understandably, she emptied the tank, locking it out in the previous one. And she bows to the audience and the judges and waves to them because everyone saw what phenomenal effort she gave trying to get it on the first time and actually showing the strength to get it, but unfortunately just struggling to not have any up-down movement. And she retains both world records in the M1 division for the deadlift and the total, extending the total another 5 kilos. That's a fantastic performance. And she may place somewhere close to the top 10, depending upon how our primetime group goes on later this afternoon.
Yeah, absolutely. A really valiant effort. And, you know, when you have a top-end lift and you just miss it on the lockout, it's going to be hard to, you know, pull that lift again, and it's very rare we see someone able to do that twice.
Especially with only 7 lifters in the flight.
Absolutely. It's a very quick turnaround and maybe 5 minutes max there to rest in between.
Absolutely.
So we are kicking off with the men's 120 plus B group deadlifts and opening up with Milan Smiljanic of Serbia, 245 kilos.
And you can see this gentleman, very good bench presser, 225, and that unfortunately means that his limb proportions are not well built for the deadlift, so he is one of the better benchers, but the first one out on a deadlift.
Making
the most of it, he is a super pulling sumo, as you can see, and that's often what happens when you have a super heavyweight who's a very good bench presser.
Yeah, and as we know, the current deadlift record in the 120 plus for the men's opens belongs to Jesus Oliveiras at 410 kilos, which he got in March of this year. So perhaps we won't see someone stabbing for that in this B group, but...
Not in this B group. In fact, the only one taking a stab at any records in the super heavies is going to be Jesus Oliveiras himself. And he is quite the outlier. One thing that has historically been the case is that you'll see the deadlift kind of plateau somewhere around the 93 to 105 region, and you won't see a huge discrepancy between classes, but Jesus Oliveiras is like no other man.
And Lukasz Niziopoulos now making light work of 280 kilos, just like his squat and bench opener, pretty conservative, and choosing to wear knee sleeves, which some lifters choose to do to try and hide soft knees a little bit at lockout on deadlift. Obviously, the trade-off for that is there's some friction on the bar on your knee sleeve. So, you know, give some and take some.
Yeah, I think it is a risk, Amelia. And you will see, for example, it looks like there's chalk all over his thighs. It's not chalk, folks. That's actually baby powder. And the whole reason that lifters will put baby powder, like you can see here on Jackson Stubberfield, or Stubbs as he's called, is because the bar then has less friction on the thigh. So adding knee sleeves essentially does the opposite. So it better be worth it.
So Jackson Stubberfield now, 300 kilos. We had a slight misload, but they caught it earlier. And he is now going for the correct load on the bar, which is 300 kilos.
Now, if they hadn't caught that and he had deadlifted that misloaded bar, he would have been given credit for what was loaded, but he also would have the opportunity, if he didn't want it, to pull again if he missed. Not if he didn't want it, excuse me.
Yeah, and we've seen once this championships that somebody has lifted a loaded bar, it's three white lights, lifted a misloaded bar, which I believe was 5 kilos misloaded on one side, and did a really good job of getting it up, and they fixed that with the jury, but obviously it makes hard work for the lifter. But spotters and loaders are here all day, every day, so they're only human.
And to err is human, Amelia. Said somebody.
Pepe Van Zyl of South Africa, 300 kilos on the bar.
Very solid pull. There was an itty-bitty little lock and unlock of his knees that I suspect might become maybe more pronounced as he gets heavier. Or perhaps he was just so fast in that lift he didn't notice it. You might be able to spot it on the replay, but certainly not enough to... See that? Certainly not enough to probably get a call.
A little wobble there, I see it. But three white lights nonetheless. We have Sean Koch of Switzerland, 300 kilos as his opening deadlift. Currently leading in squat and bench press, I believe.
He's a classic example of a subtotal lifter who is very good at the bench, very good at the squat, and of course, elite world-class level in the deadlift, as he's here today in Malta. But it means that he finds himself playing the waiting game when he's in close competition, like any person who is not necessarily as good at the deadlift as they are at the squat and bench, hoping that they've put enough ground between them and the lifters that they can't catch up to him.
Yeah, and I think he's going to end up with a pretty hefty total and perhaps even good enough to get himself into the top 10 there. I think he's actually nominated 10th as it stands, but with that opening deadlift, he matches his nominated total.
So he's either made some great progress or the nominated total that he put up was not him pushing the limits. And here we see a beltless, looked like a grip error.
Yeah, Jacek Juszczyk of Poland there with 300 kilos. Let's see if we can see on the replay again. He manages to get it up to almost lockout. And then just here, yeah.
Yeah, you can see his right hand slipped right at the top. Unfortunately, I hope he didn't tear any calluses, but unfortunately, it's hard to adjust grip mid-competition.
Yeah.
Although the Polish coaching staff are quite experienced. If there are any tricks up their sleeve, they'll have it.
Hopefully he can pack his hand with chalks and just hope for the best in a second.
And I would absolutely ask to clean the bar if I was the coaches next time he came out to make sure there was no chalk packed into the knurling, or you essentially don't have knurling.
310 kilos moving very quickly for Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei there. And yeah, amongst chalk, you're likely to get caught up of talcum powder, which is going to be much worse, you know, for grip there.
Yeah, the deadlift is by far the most important time to clean the bar, because as you're stating, Amelia, you get the talcum powder transferred from the lifter's thighs onto the bar, which you absolutely don't want on your hands. And even if it is just chalk on the bar, you don't want it so tightly and thickly packed on the knurling that you don't get the benefit of that friction.
Alexander Ren of Austria now, 310 kilos. Been looking strong all day. And his deadlift opener is not an exception and is a good lift. It's so hard to tell sometimes when you get to these bigger men that they're fully locked out, and clearly he was. But as the shoulders get bigger, it's harder and harder to pull them back, or to at least see how far they've been pulled back.
That's right. Big knees, big shoulders, big humans here pulling big weights, and that's no exception for Mehdi Mafigolani from Iran, who's opening at 315. He is the other very large subtotal lifter who's coming in with a massive squat of 387 and a very respectable bench of 205. And let's see how he goes with 315. Very solid, especially considering that he's coming off of a Masters M1 world record squat.
Yeah, and by the looks of the subtotals, or the, you know, it seems that there will be maybe four lifters in this B flight that will reach 900 and above on their total.
Yeah, this is it's impressive to see that powerlifting has grown to the point where we're getting a solid stable of competitive super heavies. As at the extreme ends of the weight class continuum, you do start to see just fewer competitors. It's a less common body type.
Steve Ringoot now, Belgium, opening on 320 kilos.
Looks like a solid attempt.
Yeah, and a good lift. And if he's able to add 20 kilos more over the next two deadlifts, he will reach above 900 kilos for his total, which I think is fairly reasonable to expect.
I think so.
Yari Sario coming out now as the heaviest opener of this flight, B120+. Opening on 335, you can see here his best deadlift is 362.5, so 335 is a weight that hopefully we can expect him to move well.
And then we'll probably see something, if it does, like a 15 to 20 kilo jump, putting him in a good spot to maybe go for a personal best. Another relatively rare sumo puller in the super heavyweight division. Pretty solid there.
That is a good lift.
One of the things you'll hear from super heavies is that they find just navigating around their own body size to pull becomes an issue, which is probably one of the reasons why you see fewer sumo pullers as you move into the supers, and also why deadlifts also tend to plateau more generally. Another thing to consider is that weight classes are basically height classes in disguise. And so you tend to see a lot of covariance between being taller and being heavier. So that bar gets further and further away from you.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely see some outliers there, but the general consensus kind of stays the same.
Absolutely.
Milan Smiljanic of Serbia, jumping 10 kilos to 255 for a second attempt.
And that is unique to the deadlift, because the squat, of course, is on your back and the bench is in your hands. but the ground stays in the same spot regardless of how tall you are.
Three white lights and a good lift. Yeah, you don't need any rack heights for deadlift.
That's right. Although next time I compete, I'm going to give them my deadlift rack height just to see how they respond.
And what would that be?
Zero.
So we have Jacek Juszczyk of Poland, who unfortunately just missed his opener of 300 kilos on grip, just at lockout. We're hoping he can get it on his second here.
Yeah, hopefully that was just maybe a little bit of baby powder on his hand and not a grip strength issue, so that it's something he can correct. It did look to surprise both him and his coach, so I'm hoping the grip strength is correctable.
He seems to hold on to it
then. That looks a lot better.
Yeah.
Well, that's a relief. It looks like everyone's in the competition in this flight of 120s.
So that means now everybody has a deadlift in and has secured themselves a total, which is a fantastic place to be.
Absolutely something to be proud of, just simply posting a total at the World Championships, where travel, the competition level, anxiety, nerves, everything is quite high.
Lukasz Nizio of Poland jumping 15 kilos to 305. We've come to expect some of these bigger jumps from Lukasz, as his openers have been so speedy for him.
And it slows down, but there's no obvious stick point. So I think he's probably got another big pull in him.
Yeah, and that is a three white light, good lift. And he's been, you know, hitting pretty good calls each lift. So we've come to expect pretty smooth lifting from him.
Yeah, absolutely. He's having a good day. And building a total is all about making attempts. Of course, making attempts that are close to your limit, but you have to set yourself up for that. It's not just simply coming here to try to do a max out on each one of the lifts.
Pepe Van Zyl now of South Africa, 310 kilos, a 10-kilo jump from his opener.
A little bit of a struggle as he nears the lockout, probably more than you'd want to see on a second attempt, but he is good for it, and he'll be hopefully taking a conservative third.
Yeah, that definitely seems more top end than maybe you'd want to see on your second. But he gets the lift nonetheless.
And he does well to make sure his knees and his shoulders stay locked out as he gets to the top. That is a challenge with that type of body and that type of pull at that type of load near the top end.
Sean Koch now of Switzerland, 320 kilos, which will match his personal best deadlift.
And as we've seen, he's been putting up more than his nominations in the other disciplines, so I expect this to move pretty well. Wow.
Yeah, that was very speedy, and I expect perhaps another big jump to his third.
I think so. I don't know that that looked any different than his opener.
No, that was fantastic, and that currently leaves him with a 942.5 kilo total, which is not small.
Not at all, and based on the nominations, a 942 total, and that's if he misses his third, would put him in the top eight. Of course, nominations are not final standings by any means.
Jackson Stubblefield of Australia, jumping 22.5 kilos to 322.5 for his second attempt.
In these larger weight classes, the spread from first to third can sometimes be a very large number. And a solid fight there for Jackson.
And he locks it out, three white lights. Seeing him get slightly closer to his top end there as he shakes on the way up, which you tend to see in conventional.
Yep. When the 1RMs come a-knockin', the knees struggle to lockin'.
Put that on a t-shirt.
Well, I don't have the money for that type of printing, but maybe we can talk to the IPF about it. Since I have commentated on 3 B-group sessions, I feel I'm owed the shirt. And we have Mafi Gholami from Iran on 330. This is a 15-kilo jump. This will take him well into the 900s.
And he gets up. The question is, are they happy with his lockout?
2 of them are. And let's see if the jury agrees. I saw someone nod.
The issue is there. This is the side that I saw where I was unsure of it. So we can't quite see what the center and left side referees saw, but they seemed happy with the lockout.
Yeah, I think his knee further from us looks clearly locked, but his one closest to us, you know, honestly, it looked fine, but it did look, because it's less locked than the other knee, I could see the discrepancy calling the eye to it. But he will get his second attempt. There was no overturn from the jury.
Absolutely. Pei Yu Wang now, Chinese Taipei, jumping 20 kilos to 330 kilos on his third attempt.
And a solid attempt. Second attempt.
Second attempt, yep. I'm so sorry.
How dare you.
And it's a good lift, and his second attempt losing like a first attempt.
Yeah, there's a number of very strong seconds that were in this flight. Also a couple of very challenging seconds. So we'll see if people can make the right calls moving into the thirds.
Yeah, it's definitely been a mixed bag, and we're hoping to see some more successful seconds now. Steve Ringu of Belgium jumping 15 kilos to 335 for his second attempt.
And this will put him just short of 900 if he gets it, which means he will probably be able to crack into the nines on his third if he makes the right call. Solid fight at the top, struggling to get that full lockout. I think he got it, and so did the judges. Yeah. And he looks pretty happy.
That's a good lift, and leaves him on his second attempt just shy of that 900-kilo total mark, as you said. As whether he has another 2.5-5 kilos left in him for that next jump. Obviously, 2.5 kilos is a small jump, but it's not 2.5 kilos he's lifting.
That's right, and it does get you to that all-satisfying 900-kilo total. So I do expect a 2.5 or a 5 based upon how that moved.
We have Alexander Renner now taking 345 kilos, a 35-kilo jump from his opener. A big jump.
Yeah, that's a massive jump. Now, as we said, if there is a lift to do it on, it's the deadlift. But he is a sumo puller, and I think it's going to be challenging to adjust to this type of load if he's got the strength without losing balance. I wish him the best. Let's see how he performs.
Wow.
Wow. What a jump. And that's going to launch him up the rankings.
Yeah, absolutely incredible there from Renner. And you know what? If you told me he was going to do a 35-kilo jump, I said, well, his opener looked good, but is 35 kilos a bit too optimistic? And
it's hard to gauge.
Yeah, and it wasn't at all. That
I
was
mean, the answer is no, but you don't get much experience seeing what a 35-kilo jump looks like.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, he made good work of it and left him in a really great place for a second going into his third. Jari Saario now of Finland, jumping 20 kilos to 355.
And this will also put him in striking distance on his third of a 900-kilo total. It slows, but there doesn't seem to be any pronounced sticking region. Was he fully locked out? 2 of the judges thought he was. And I don't see any move towards deliberation on the jury, so I think he is safe.
Yeah, and if you're not sure, you know, you err on the side of the lifter and go towards a white light.
And we already have 5 lifters in the 900s as we move into our third deadlift. And these individuals are going to be trying to put every kilo on the bar they can, as it might potentially have them in the top 10 rankings.
And we move into our third and final attempts of this 120 plus B group. Deadlifts opening up with Milan Smiljanic of Serbia, jumping 20 kilos to 275.
It's a fight, and probably just a little too much, unfortunately. That was a 20-kilo jump. I suspect something like 10 he probably could have gotten.
Well, it's interesting because he opened at 245 and then jumped 10, and then for his third proceeded to jump 20 kilos.
You know, we may be looking at him going after a national record.
Perhaps.
Or him saying, hey, you know, my best is 272, and I just want to get 275 at Worlds. Might have been a decision that he made a little late in the game, and his coaches were not expecting it. But, heck, if you're not in the contention for top 10 where you can get country points, and you're not in contention for an individual medal, or if you're in contention for a medal but it's on the first two, I would say as a coach, have a crack.
Pepe Zan Van Zyl now, South Africa, 315 kilos, a conservative 5-kilo jump.
And I think that's probably a good call, if I recall, based on his second.
Yeah.
Oh, he fights through the stick. Is that going to be ramping, though? That became a hitch at the end, and he wasn't able to pull it anyway. But a valiant effort.
Yeah, really good effort there. But once you kind of get to that point and your knees are under the bar.
And you can see right there, he's ramping. And then he does a hitch. But, hey, excellent fight. Maybe if this is a strong man, he could have found a way to get that up.
Jacek Jusik of Poland, jumping 15 kilos to 315. He missed his opener on grip, got it on his second, and it looks like he's made probably the jump he would have made to his second on his third, which I think is a sensible choice.
I would agree, making sure that grip issue doesn't rear its ugly head again. Oh, it looked like it did. Unfortunate. And we're seeing an attempt change. Typically not a common thing you see in the B flight.
Yeah, it looks like Sean of Switzerland changed his last deadlift to 335.
You remember what he was on previously, Amelia?
I think he might have pushed it up a tiny bit, if I'm being honest, just 2.5 kilos. I could be wrong, but maybe, again, he's going for some sort of record, or maybe he's fighting to get into that top 10 spot where he can collect team points for Switzerland.
They may be thinking, you know, based upon the numbers, it's just you got to get as many as possible. Or, again, you have to remember that there are national records. You can set a national record in international competition.
Jackson Stubberfield of Australia now, jumping 7.5 kilos to 330 for his final deadlift. Can he lock it out? He's shaking.
Oh, wow. He might have it. Can he keep those knees locked, though? They got to stop shaking. Oh,
wow.
It looked like they did stop shaking. I think he might get it.
Three white lights. He went from roadrunner to a statue very quickly.
That was very impressive. Absolutely. Roadrunner to a statue. A perfect analogy.
And there it stops. Looks like, it's like he can control his knees.
It almost looks like a guitar band that was strung and eventually stopped vibrating.
That's exactly what it looked like. And he gets the lift. A fantastic way to end the day. We move now to Lukasz Nizio of Poland, who's jumped 25 kilos to his third attempt, a similar jump that he made from his first to his second.
Oh, and just a little too much, but he had a good scrap. As we mentioned, we're not sure what all these lifters are necessarily going for. If you only tune in to the World Championship powerlifting event that we're hosting here in Malta, you may not be aware that there are other international competitions in different levels, for example, Europeans or Commonwealth or North Americans, as well as national and provincial records at every level in each country. And this, speaking of records, is an M1 total record by Mafi Ghulami. He is pulling 332.5, which will put him presumably just 2.5 kilos over a record, or maybe an incremental value, since this is only 2.5 more than he pulled on his second.
It looks like he changed that, so maybe realized that and pulled it down.
I suspect you're right, Amelia. And this will leave him on 9.25. Oh.
Wow.
And very tough lockout. I'm not sure he's got it.
I think just at the top there, he struggled to lock it out.
2-1. And the Iranian coach is going to go to the jury's table. Let's see. They don't seem to be deliberating, which is not a good sign.
Yeah, I think it seems like they are
shaking
their head.
Three head shakes. Nope, it's going to unfortunately remain a no lift, as you need a 3 out of 5 majority, which they did not get.
Sean from Switzerland now, who is only 23, taking a 335-kilo deadlift for his third and final attempt, a 15-kilo jump from his second.
23. Imagine that.
His second was extremely speedy. So let's see how 15 kilos affects him.
Wow, there's more left there, folks.
I'm wondering if he managed to stay in that top position long enough to get the down command. He did.
Yep. Yet, I think you're right. That's a good eye that you spotted that. Almost deceptively fast, as it seems to be most challenging at the top. If you watch here, he's starting to already come down before he gets the full down command, but got it in the nick of time.
Yeah, and, you know, it's one thing pulling the weight, but then keeping the weight in your hand is another thing altogether.
That's right.
We have Steve Ringu of Belgium now pulling 337.5, a 2.5-kilo jump from his second, which was quite hard, and he's reaching for that 900-kilo total.
I think he wants the milestone. He's totaled more than this, but I'm sure just finishing the competition at the world level with a 900 would mean something to him. He's got the crowd support, you can hear it. And he's nearly there, but just unfortunate, not today.
It's a little bit too much. We still end on a massive 897.5 total.
Yeah, very respectable. Going back to what you were saying, Amelia, about holding the bar is not the same as just simply completing the lift and briefly being there. That is a trainable trait. You can absolutely, as a coach, have your lifter and encourage them to hold their lockouts for a long period of time. Sometimes you'll see lifters just want to get out of Dodge as soon as they get there. And that can leave them in a position where on game day, they're unable to finish when they get to their top end.
Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei now, jumping 15 kilos to 345. This will take him to a 920 total.
Let's see if he can be successful with it.
Wow.
Wow. Now, the knees were just a very touch soft, but I think they weren't too soft, which is fantastic. That's three white lights. And I think I know why he's wearing these sleeves.
They seem to aid him well. Now, with just two lifters left to deadlift, we have Alexander Renner up out first of Austria with 360 kilos, another 15-kilo jump, made a 35-kilo jump from his first to second, and it didn't slow him down all too much. So let's see how 360 goes for him.
And he's got the Austrian team behind him, a lot of people in the audience. Everyone wants to see him get this.
This will take him to a 900-kilo total.
This is a milestone lift for a lot of reasons. Taking his time as a sumo puller, making sure he's got the right position, but also getting the right level of arousal. It passes the knees. Oh, he's still going. I'm not sure he fully locked out, though, Amelia.
Yeah, we'll have to see what the referees say. Unfortunately.
One light, and the Austrian team is going to the jury. And once again, we're in a situation where we need to get a 3 out of 5 ruling for that to get overturned. They're watching.
Yeah, should he get it, it'll be a 20-kilo total PB for him.
I see one thumb up.
We'll keep an eye on that and let you know if anything changes there.
Oh, it is overturned. He gets it. Fantastic.
There we go. And that is why it's worth going to the jury if you get that one white light.
Absolutely. That white light is your door opening to possible success, bringing you past the failure.
Now we have our final deadlift of this session of 120 plus B group, with Jari Saario of Finland jumping to 367.5 kilos for his third and final attempt.
Yep. And his knees look like they're not quite locked, unfortunately.
He celebrates, but...
Hey, like I said, you put on the airs of success regardless of what you think might have happened, because you don't know what you're going to get ruled. And that is a successful lift.
And that concludes this 120 plus B session here. And we can see where we're sitting currently at the moment with deadlifts. Provisionally, before we have the A flight later today, we have Saario of Finland sitting in provisional gold, followed by Alexander Renner.
Oh, unfortunately, it looks like Sario's last deadlift has been overruled, I believe.
I think that's just some...
is that a technical error coming after the buzzer?
It doesn't look like it's been changed quite yet, but we can see here the totals provisionally, with Sean of Switzerland in first, Mehdi of Iran in second, and Pei Yu Wang of Chinese Taipei sitting in third. This is subject to change with the A flight that we will see coming later today. Don't go anywhere. The medal ceremony will be then. See you later.
And it was not overturned.